yeah, popping bottles on the GNCC podium. That sweet, sweet taste of victory.
Everybody's feeling great.
Yep. You got your line picked out at Howard's Hole?
I don't. The spectators told me that I was Stu Baylor. I was royalty down there. They were going to carry me through it.
It's pretty good, but this is Snowshoe Mountain. Are you ready to go? GNCC Racing! Off in row number one, it's Jordan Ashburn and Stu Baylor up front. Stu Baylor goes down. Stu Baylor down, row two off. Brendan Snodgrass, Josh Trump, Ricky Russell, Craig Malone, and Johnny Girard.
We just saw a moment ago, Jordan Ashburn still in the lead, at least for the moment. But Stu Baylor completely erased that gap he had in between one and two right there. So definitely a battle. I got to think they're handlebar to handlebar right now. And then Ben Kelly coming through. Big gap between second and third right now. So moving through the Monster Mile, or better known as Howard's Hole here in Snowshoe, West Virginia.
Ben Kelly that we've been all waiting to see. Well, he showed up here at Snowshoe today, and he's going to take the win at the Yamaha Snowshoe GNCC. A little wheelie for the
third. Ramping up so bad for the third lap.
Long time coming, man. All right, where's your head at now heading into summer break with the points lead coming off the win?
Same old, you know. I just go out there and give it the best every time, and, you know, since I had the points lead for so long and, you know, even if I didn't win, like, I still had the points lead. So it was a weird, like, feeling, like, just mentally it was stressful. And it was like I didn't have to win to have the points lead. So it's like, I don't know. It's like just that last little couple percent just wasn't there to get the win. And, you know, I had to get the win here to keep the points lead. So that's what I did.
That's what he did. There you go. Your winner here today on the KTM, Ben Kelly. Locked and loaded down here with Stu Baylor. Stu, we know you wanted the win. You didn't need the win, but you did need to finish in front of Ben Kelly, and today that would have meant the win, man.
A lot of issues today. I was really frustrated with myself, frustrated with a lot of things that were going on. But, you know, we'll come back. I like I said before the race, you know, it's not do or die. I know I'm the guy to beat right now, and I think I've proven that, and you know, moving forward to those final few rounds, I know that I'll have to be paying for diapers, so got to bust ass.
That's right, man. That's what I was going to say. Hey, when we come back to GNCC, I know Jade's watching at home, man. When we come back, you're going to be a dad. How are you feeling about that?
Terrified.
We'll leave it at that. Stu Baylor, he says, I'm terrified. Racing, fine. Becoming a dad, terrifying. Well, Jordan, man, taking a third-place finish here today, battling for the lead many, many times, battling for seconds, into the day on third. Solid day for Jordan Ashburn.
Yeah, I was happy to get up here on the mountain and get back on the podium, you know. Been up here quite a bit at this race, and it's kind of tailors to my style of riding. And, I felt good all through the day and just made a few mistakes and let those guys get away. And, you know, once they got away, you get in between some lappers, the dust was really bad on one side, and, you know, you could just lose a lot of time. But it was a great day. I'm pretty happy with my ride, and, yeah.
Well, you just became a dad within the last couple of weeks, man. How did that kind of change your mindset coming into today and moving forward as a pro rider?
Man, it's amazing. I don't know. It's just a blessing from the Lord, and just so happy that to have two healthy babies, and, you know, it just fuels my fire even more.
Mama's back home watching. She messages during the show. Mary Ashburn's got to be happy right now with those two babies. There you go. Jordan Ashburn taking third place today.
It's okay. I get it. You guys make some noise for your top three. Come on, man. You act like you're tired. There you go. Popping bottles on the GNCC podium. Make some noise one more time. Jordan Ashburn, Stu Baylor, and Ben Kelly. And you guys make some noise for your top three in the XC2.
I'm Governor Jim Justice. I cannot possibly be any more excited than to have you here. This event, absolutely coming to West Virginia, is unprecedented how much it's worth and how much value it is to us. You'll find us as a loving, appreciative people. And by that, I mean appreciative is the key word, because we will appreciate you being here. Absolutely, I hope you have an incredible time here in West Virginia. And again, thank you so much for enjoying this incredible, almost heaven state.
Oh, say can you see? It's September 12th, and we're GNCC Racing. Welcome back from summer break and to Glen Jean, West Virginia, the home of the Mountaineer GNCC. Some time has passed since we saw checkers fly on top of Snowshoe Mountain, but not much has changed atop the points of the XC1 class, and it's Sunday. And it's time for some pro bike racing. Ben Kelly leads Stu Baylor by just 9 points heading into round 10. At Snowshoe, we saw BK grab some momentum back from a humbled Stu Baylor. And while Stu won here last year, all signs are pointing to a good day for the KTM mounted points leader. This track is rough and rocky and rugged and plays right into Kelly's wheelhouse. But while the championship may come down to those two, who's to say another rider won't step up and take the win here today? Lane Michael cut his teeth on West Virginia rocks, and you can never count out the Aussie Josh Strang. The weather is perfect, and another stage is set for the first fall round of GNCC racing. We tip our hats to all of our first responders and military men and women, not just today, but every day. From Racer Productions and GNCC Racing Nation, thank you for all that you do, have done, or will do tomorrow. We are proud Americans, and we owe it all to you. We wouldn't be here without you. It's the land of the free and the home of the brave. And as part of the West Virginia Fish and Game Outdoor Expo and Freedom Fest, we're as ready as we're going to get and can't wait any longer for the green flag. Catch it all next, live on Racer TV.
Are you ready to go GNCC Racing?
Hello and welcome to America's Premier Off-Road Racing Championship, the 2021 Grand National Cross Country Series presented by Specialized and AMA National Championship. I'm Rodney Tomlin along with Mikey Waynes, and today we come from Beckley, West Virginia at the Summit Bechtel Reserve, or the Scout Camp that a lot of people know it as, and of course, one of the new premier stops on the GNCC Tour that we started about 3 or 4 years ago. And Mikey, I got to tell you, as we roll into this one, it's certainly going to be the biggest ever here.
Oh, yeah.
With things going on next door with the West Virginia Outdoor Show. They're calling it the Adventure On Freedom Fest. It's a lot of great things going on over there. And we've got GNCC Racing, and everybody's mixing and mingling together. And we've got outdoor folks that are coming to check out the hunting displays, coming to check out the racing. We've got racers going to check out the hunting. It's an amazing weekend here so far.
Yeah, everything's intermingled. And I got to say, if you are one of the folks that are sitting at home, this is a one that I think next year you got to circle.
Yeah.
And you say, I got to make that one. This is right up there, I think, with your Camp Cokers, your John Pentons. We were talking about this off air, Rodney. Iron Man, Big Buck. This is a premier event, no doubt about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and it's becoming, I think, pretty much par for the course for each event that we go to
yeah.
be premier facility, though not all of them are. We are getting leaning toward that, and who would have guessed that this one would become the premier event that is. The governor of West Virginia is behind
yeah.
it, and I mean, a lot of folks are really banking on this being a big weekend, and that's exactly what it is. And of course, this being the 9/11 weekend, we pay homage and commemorate the 9/11, and of course we pay honor to all of our first responders here this weekend as well.
Yep.
So a lot of things going on this weekend as well. The return to racing, Mikey
yeah.
Waynes, something we haven't done here in at least GNCC for a couple months now. And a lot of things have been going on in the offseason. Stu Baylor's been out there tracking down that National Enduro Championship. The ISD has been run, and here we are ready to go back to GNCC. And when we look at it, we got a 9-point difference as far as the championship points race between Stu Baylor and Ben Kelly. But then whenever you look back to the third place position, Jordan Ashburn, Grant Baylor, and Josh Strang, there are 5 points that separate those riders for third place. Talk about a championship points battle this year. This has got to be probably one of the most closely knit battles to the top 10 that I've seen in a long time, especially in that top five like that.
Yeah, that nails it. Obviously, the social media, the media attention seems to be on Ben Kelly and Stu Baylor, rightfully so. But, hey, when you look at the big picture, those three guys in third, fourth, and fifth, they've all got a shot of being that number three guy when this season ends. So a lot at stake for these guys. As we call it, silly season has begun. A lot of guys, maybe the ride is not guaranteed next year. Maybe they didn't perform this season to the best of their ability, and they want to go out and prove to their team and their sponsors, hey, I'm the guy. You still want me. I promise. I'm going to prove it to you today.
A couple of guys I think out this weekend that I know for sure that I've talked to. Grant Baylor, I don't think he's going to be making. I think he's still on the injured list. Had some incidents over the summer during the summer break. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, Ricky Russell may not be making the starting line. I don't have the details on that, but we'll get those disclosed as the day wears on as far as the XC1 Pro class is concerned. As far as XC2 Pro Lights class is concerned there in the two-wheel side of things, Jonathan Gerard really been, I mean, he has been an animal this year. But Greg DeLong, we've seen the rise back in his attitude. He's really become a lot more aggressive in a lot of races, and we're starting to see that push from him. And then, of course, great consistent rides out of Cody Barnes as well. He's a little far back as far as third place, and there's a good separation between first and second. But with four rounds to go, we know there's a lot of things that can go on. Jonathan Gerard, though, he's very consistent.
Oh, yeah.
He's very fast, and he's going to be hard to beat. Craig DeLong's going to have his hands full, so this is going to be interesting as far as the XC2 side of things is concerned. And I think that third-place battle that we were looking at in points is going to get pretty exciting as well in that XC2. Now, on the FMF XC3 125 Pro-Am side of things, Jonathan Johnson, who, wow, I mean, this guy at the beginning of the year, all year, has been the force to be reckoned
yeah.
with. I mean, it's been basically, Mikey, the road to the championship goes through Jonathan Johnson.
No doubt about that. One big name up there in the number two spot is Chase Colville.
Yep.
He's a whole shot machine.
Yep.
He's just trying to figure out, all right, how can I put together that perfect 3-hour race on the 125? I look to see Chase Colville knocking on the door, maybe battling with Jonathan Johnson these last four rounds.
Yeah, and you know, he's getting it figured out. We saw him run more consistently in front like that, so I think we're going to see that a little more. Chase right now, he's solid in the second place position, but there are some riders that could sneak up. Ben Parsons being one of those, only a handful of points back there in that class as well. So that one's getting pretty exciting as far as down to the wire. And I got to say a lot about the FMF XC3 125 Pro-Am class. Seen a lot of growth in the last couple of years in this class. And not only the growth has brought the exciting racing in that division as well. So it's exciting all the way around. Again, four rounds of racing left to go. In my opinion, anything can happen and anything goes as far as that. And when we started out here in the rocks and mountains of West Virginia, there's always something, Mikey, that that the track crew, maybe not even necessarily the track crew, has got special for them, but the race and this mountain and these mountains that happen to have for these riders, because they could really jumble things up as far as this, this return to GNCC is concerned.
That's exactly it. And with that said, we'll throw it down to the expert behind it all, Mr. Jared Bolton.
Hey, you guys heard the word? GNCC Racing is back from summer break. And, man, I couldn't think of a better place to do it than right here at the Summit Vector Reserve for the Mountaineer GNCC. Boy, this piece of property is beautiful. The trails are awesome. And guess what? I'm not going to say there's a little something for everybody out there, because this actually caters to a more technical rider. It's very rocky. The woods are thick. The trees are dense. It kind of keeps the moisture in the ground. So not only is it rocky, it's a little wet in places. So those rocks get wet, get slick rock. This is one of those places where the guys that are really good at the technical stuff are going to shine. There's not too many opportunities that open it up and go really fast. So the guys that are good at that, they're going to struggle a little bit this weekend. But hey, that's the thing about GNCC racing. It's so diverse. It's so much different stuff you encounter all throughout the season. Never know what's going to happen next. That's this weekend's track description. Back to you guys.
Thanks a lot, Jared. And it sounds like you guys have been busy working on a perfect race trail. I can't wait to see what this one turns out like and what kind of racing we're going to have at the end of the day, Mikey.
The stage is set. Hey, Rodney and I have talked the talk. Jared Bolton gave you the track description. We need to get a word from our wonderful sponsors. And when we come back, Rodney Tomlin will be down on the starting line with those iconic 10-second calls.
Rocky Mountain ATV MC, retailer, distributor, manufacturer, product developer, parts tester. This is what we do. But who we are is something much simpler. We're riders, like you. 100% employee owned and operated, a company built by riders, entirely for riders. Rocky Mountain ATV MC, get ready.
The directive: advance human performance beyond biological limitation.
This Racer TV broadcast is brought to you by Specialized Turbo E-Bikes. It's you, only faster. And by Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
Once again, folks, and welcome along the World Wide Web at RacerTV.com as we come to you live from Beckley, West Virginia, here at the Bechtel Summit Reserve for our 10th round of America's Premier Off-Road Racing Championship and the resumption of the 2021 GNCC Series and, of course, the kickoff, I like to call it, to the final leg of GNCC Racing. And I'll tell you, we have got a major stage set here in this 2021 championship season as the championship, coming down to the wire. I think I was doing some math. We're somewhere in the neighborhood. What is it, something like 9 points or something like that?
Yep.
9 points, and Stu Baylor, who we got here with us right now, missing the first round of racing, having a rough second round of racing. So basically, you come into this championship way behind the eight ball, Stu, but man, you've had some good momentum, it looks like, throughout the course of the 2021 season.
Yeah, definitely. You know, I changed everything last year and showed up on a blue bike at this race, and you know, things started clicking, and I started clicking off win after win, and I've had a lot of momentum since that day. So I was able to carry it into this season. Obviously, a little bit bumpy there at the beginning, but you know, I'm really looking forward to these final four.
Well, I guess we should say happy anniversary to you then, shouldn't we?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's amazing how we started a year ago. This was a race-by-race deal that you had going on with everything that took place in the summer and the offseason, well, the pandemic, I guess, of the break of 2020. And with that, whenever we came back from the summer break, you came out with a vengeance. You had a point to prove. And that point, I don't know if it's been proven yet, has it?
No, I mean, I think I proved it last year, but I'm still want to click off some more wins, and you know, I'd love to get that elusive GNCC championship now that Caleb's standing on the sideline instead of in front of me.
But with that, coming back here to West Virginia, I mean, this some people could say it's a traditional GNCC, but what we run nowadays, there's not a lot of rocks and as many hill climbs and as hard packed as what we've got here at the summit, it seems like. I mean, this is really one of those challenging race courses. I've heard people liken it to even snowshoe with some of the difficulties in some of the sections.
Yeah, definitely. You know, I would say that this track may not have some of the extreme technicality that snowshoe has in certain areas. It doesn't have quite the mud that they have, but overall, I think this may be even more demanding. You know, on the as far as looking at the technical side, it's kind of one after another, little rock gardens here and there, and as we race, more develop. So this race, the first year, I came out here, and this was more like what I'm used to, National Enduro style. We haven't been racing here a lot, and led the majority of the day, and then last lap I'm off and the finish blew up, and then last year I was at least able to top that and pull off a win here, so I'm really looking forward to it. But they threw in some new sections and some really cool bike only that's going to separate the guys. I'm just hoping that Bolton doesn't get soft on us and take it out after lap one.
Well, there you go. Sounds like you know what you got in store for you, and what are you expecting out of the end of the day today?
You know, I'm just expecting to have fun on my dirt bike at the end of the day. You know, I love this track. It's really fun. And, you know, everybody has these expectations after summer break or when you come into the season. And I think that was a big turning point for me, was I didn't put any expectations on myself last year and I started riding better. So at the end of the day, I'm coming out here giving it my all. I want to win. Obviously, every one of us want to win with every ounce in our body. But at the end of the day, I found out it's not going to change anything when you're sitting on the sideline. So go out, have fun, and that's what I'm doing.
All right, let's go out and have some fun. Looks like Jared Bolton has made his way in, and our course descriptions can get underway. So we'll turn things over to our junior trail boss and co-course designer, Jared Bolton, as he'll give us an idea of what we can expect as far as today's GNCC course here at the Mountaineer.
Oh, yeah, thank you, Rodney. Man, Judd was quick with that microphone. I've never seen him run like that. That was impressive. Okay, so I've kind of been telling everybody all weekend, if you like hard-packed slick stuff and slick rocks, you're going to absolutely love this. If you're not real big on that, which I'm not, to be honest, it's still fun. I've still enjoyed riding it, even though I'm not a super huge fan of those slick rocks. So you're going to take off from the start here. You're actually starting just a little bit before the 1 mile mark. So your first lap's going to be just a little bit quicker than the other ones. Kind of run around the edge of the field here. Drop down in the woods at the 1 mile mark to your very first rock garden. I know you guys have all walked it and everything. The line everybody seems to be taking is that far right one. Seems to be the really good one. If it gets plugged up, the lower left one's just fine as well. But everybody all weekend's been doing it. The youth have done it, so should be a cakewalk for you guys. You come back up to the edge of the field for just a second, then you're dropping back down in the woods. That's the last time you really see the field until you get to the finish. Good long wood section. Drop down in the woods there. Good ups and downs, off camber, rocks, all that good stuff. All the way to the 2 mile mark to the 3 mile mark. All of that stuff's in for you guys. About the 3.2, you're crossing over the road, and it's like the world changes. You get over into the drier dirt. The other side of that little gravel road is awesome. The morning didn't run the section over there. You guys are going to do it. good up and down, off camber. None of that is flat all the way to the 4 mile mark. There's nothing flat. It's a really fun section. The quads rode it yesterday, so there's plenty of it's burn in. You know where to go. That'll bring you back down, tie back into the morning track. Pretty fun little section through there. It'll take you up a little climb, flattens out for just a little bit, and then you're going to drop up and down a couple of times over the 5 mile mark. And then a little past the five, you got another good rock garden. It's a little bit bigger. It's got a bunch of different lines through it as well. The morning rode it. Even the beginning of the morning race, they really didn't have too much trouble with it. So, again, you guys should blast right through that section. That'll bring you back around, cross over the power line, another kind of open section all the way to the 6 mile mark. Good stuff out through there. Starts to get a little slick, rocky again between the 6 and the 7. You're kind of going up and downhill through a little, couple little low-lying wet areas all the way over the 7 mile mark. Kind of opens up again, and then past the 7, you guys will split off into that bike only section. The morning ram part of it, you'll run through that same stuff, and then about halfway through that bike section, you guys are going to split off. You'll run a new section. If you rode here 2 years ago, you've ridden this. If not, it's going to be brand new to you. It'll take you through some good technical trail. Now, guys, listen up, and especially guys up front, the downhill at the beginning of that section, those rocks are really big. It's pretty steep. I know I'm like preaching to the choir here because you guys are pros, but still, be really, really careful on that, man. I'm serious. We rode quads down it, and we're going, oh, my gosh, that's a little sketchy. So you guys just be really careful on that, especially first time through until it gets a good line burn into it. That'll take you down the big rock garden. There's 3 or 4 different lines through it. Work your way through that, and you got a long uphill section tied back into the bike, the part of the bike section of the bike, the morning ran. That'll bring you over to the 8 mile mark, and then it's kind of dropping off past the 8 mile mark. You got a long, steep downhill. Same thing on that. Be really, really careful. It's super steep. Nobody's rode it except for me and Ryan went down it on quads a couple days ago, and I swore I'm never taking a quad down it again. But on a bike, it's nothing. So you guys be really careful on that downhill that first time through until it gets a good line burn into it, because it's going to be kind of slick. That'll bring it down into the bottom there. Long, fast section bring you out to the 9 mile mark, and then you're going to right past the 9 mile mark, you're splitting off into the FMF PowerPoint section. Another little good rock garden there right below that monster mile. Bring you back onto some faster stuff over to the 10. You're running up past the 10, up into the finish. Right out of the finish, you're going through the probe pits, and then you're going to come tie back in right here at the back of the start. Little wood section to tie back in where you started at. So with that bike section added in, you guys are about 11 and a quarter. Really good stuff out there. And hope you guys enjoyed. Hope you guys enjoyed as much as I have, because it's been a blast this weekend. So good luck. Be safe, have fun, and pay attention to those arrows, especially when you get in that new bike section.
Safety first. GNCC racing, like all motorsports, can be dangerous. Racers, now that you have had an opportunity to inspect the course, have heard the race procedures and a description of the course, if you feel that either you or your machine is not prepared, then now is the time for you to withdraw for a complete refund of your entry fee, no questions asked. It is your responsibility to operate your machine in a safe manner, maintaining control at all times. Extreme caution is required when approaching areas with high concentrations of fans. Do not take unnecessary risks that endanger the safety of fans. You will be penalized for reckless racing. Race fans, due to the nature of GNCC racing, there is no fence barrier around the race course. It is your responsibility to keep yourself and your children a safe distance from the race course. Never turn your back on oncoming racers, and remember, stay off the racetrack. For the safety of everyone, unauthorized drones are prohibited and will be confiscated. Finally, these are challenging times, and we must all do our part to keep ourselves and each other safe from infectious disease. Please maintain a safe 6-foot distance from people you do not live with, and wear a face mask when you cannot social distance. Wash your hands and use hand sanitizer often. Although this may be somewhat inconvenient, it is necessary for your safety. Thank you for your cooperation.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to meet our starting lineup. Coming to the line today, in accordance to points through the first 9 rounds of the 2021 GNCC Championship,
and rolling to the line first today with a 9-point lead heading into the final four rounds of the 2021 season. He hails from Harwinton, Connecticut, on board the number 530 Trail Jesters KTM, backed by FMF, Ben Kelly. Rolling to the line second today in points. He won here 1 year ago. Hailing from Hodges, South Carolina, on the 514 Ampro Yamaha, Stu Baylor. Rolling to the line today, third in points, riding aboard the number 3 from Livingston, Tennessee, on the Magna One Motorsports-backed Husqvarna, Jordan Ashburn. Rolling to the line next aboard the 114 from Denver, North Carolina, by way of Australia, on the Babbitts Online Team Green Monster Energy Kawasaki, the Freight Train, Josh Strang. Riding aboard the number 206, he hails from Winsted, Connecticut, on an FMF KTM factory racing machine, Josh Toad. The number 523, eighth in points, from Boonville, North Carolina, up on an Ampro Yamaha, Rain Michael. Riding aboard the number 989 from Williamstown, West Virginia, currently ninth in points on the Rockstar Energy Factory Racing Husqvarna, Bad Thad DuPont. The 739 from Morganton, North Carolina, on the Rockstar Energy Factory Racing Husqvarna, Trevor Bollinger. The 543 from Chile, on the Red Bull MCS Racing Sherco, Benjamin Herrera. And that, ladies and gentlemen, your starting lineup for this, the Rocky Mountain ATV MC Mountaineer GNCC. And as these riders find their way to the starting line, we turn our attention one more time to our Monster Energy Activation Transport, where we have a word from our Director of Operations, Mr. Tim Cotter.
Thank you, Rodney. It is great to be back GNCC Racing, amen? It's awesome to be back here in almost heaven, West Virginia. I would like to introduce the General Manager of the Bechtel Summit Reserve. Patrick Sterrett is with us today. Patrick is part of the Boy Scout organization. He's the vice president of the Boy Scouts and has been now brought to West Virginia. Come on up, Patrick. And we are so happy to be on your ranch or on the Scouts ranch. It's a wonderful place. Thank you for having us.
Tim, it's great to have you out here at the Summit Bechtel Reserve. We're super proud today that we got our own guy riding, one of our own staff members, James Clark, number 824 out there. James, we're pumped. We're out here watching you. We got some of the staff here. It is awesome to have all of you out here. This is exactly what we want to be using this facility for. So thanks for being here. Have a safe race and a great race. And Tim, thanks for coming to this spot.
Thank you for having us, Patrick, and we will be back. You know, folks, as we sit here, 20 years ago yesterday was the anniversary of 9/11. Many of you have already been to our starting lines throughout the weekend, and you know how we feel about it. 2,977 Americans died 20 years ago, and 19 Al-Qaeda terrorists. We remember those men and women. Most were civilians that went to work one day just like any other day. Then the world fell apart. But we here in America are so fortunate that we have folks that protect us, both foreign and domestic. And we are grateful for that. I have with me a certificate. This certificate is from the 389th Expeditionary Fighter Squadron, the T-Bolts. This flag was flown over the Middle East on March 2nd of 2020 and an F-15E Strike Eagle. This certificate is for the GNCC racers and their family. This flag that Ricky holds was purposely put in this aircraft for you. It was to honor our GNCC families, when in fact, we should be honoring those men and women that protect our borders. It was part of Operation Inherent Resolve. The call sign was Dude 01, and the tail number was 870183 Wyatt Earp. It was piloted by Paul Poncho Johnson on that day. He is a captain of the United States Air Force. The weapons system officer was Timothy Joker Morris, a major in the United States Air Force. Ladies and gentlemen, this flag is yours. It was meant for you and the freedoms that we enjoy, and must we never forget that. With your permission, this flag will stay in our office in Morgantown, and from time to time we will bring it out to remind us how important our freedom is, and that freedom is not free. Thank you, Ricky. Incidentally, today's Ricky's birthday. I promised we wouldn't sing to him this second time. But you know, on this starting line, we look at these tremendous athletes. We all aspire to be them, and they are our heroes. But the heroes are the men and women that serve our country and serve our community. Not just in the military, but in your local police department, in your EMS, or your Department of Natural Resources. And there are many. women that are here on this line. And we've had nearly 200 throughout the weekend. And that's pretty awesome that they're amongst us. One of the things that we have missed over the past 2 months is the spiritual words from Ricky Towery, who is about now to give us our invocation. Ricky.
I want to thank each and every one of y'all for what you've done for us each and every day. Thank you so much. Let's go, Lord, and let's have a word of prayer together this afternoon. Heavenly Father, you brought us back together after a summer break to have some fun together. Lord, you brought us such a beautiful place on such a beautiful day. We just ask you to be with these riders and keep them safe this afternoon. Lord, we come to the final race of the weekend. We done had so much fun already. We just ask you to let us have a few more hours this afternoon. Lord, once again, we ask you to be with the people in Waverly, Tennessee. There were some lives lost there. We ask you to be with them, that they can find some comfort through you, and that they can get their lives back in order quick as is possible. Lord, 20 years ago, 9/11 happened. So many lives were lost. So many lives were changed, Lord. Our lives was changed. But we kept moving forward because you were there with us, and you guided us and helped us through the days. And we thank you for being with us each and every day. Continue to be with us. Continue to watch over this country, the greatest country in the world. We've had problems. We'll have more problems. But you're always there with us, and we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for the Boy Scouts for letting us use this piece of property to enjoy our sport. Be with all the volunteers that helps them each and every day. Lord, once again, take us all home safely when it's over with, so we can get back together again one day to have some more fun. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, if you would, please stand at attention, remove those caps, and cross those hearts as we honor the greatest nation in the world for the playing of our national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free? And the
yes. Thanks to Tin Man Push for providing us with that spirited rendition of the Star Spangled Banner. And of course, as our riders get themselves ready to go, we take these closing and final steps to set this stage to get this race up and rolling. And of course, with all things in motion, and DJ Judd exits the stage, we ask him one final time for the weekend. DJ Judd, would you please, my kind friend, remove the meat? The Monster Energy Activation Transport now making its way off the starting line. That's what we call meat, my friends.
And, of course, Judd takes it away, and we open that first turn wide open for things to get underway here. And once that leaves that first turn region, all of a sudden that first turn becomes the property of one man named Ricky Towery, as he will take control of the real estate here in just a few moments and get this race underway here in the mountains of West Virginia. We left West Virginia before the summer break at Snowshoe. We return here at Summit Bechtel. And, of course, we are ready to roll into this final leg of the 2021 season as Ricky gets set to signal these riders. 1 minute. 1 minute before the start of today's racing action. So many folks anticipating this moment and this day as we embark on those final four rounds for the championship. 9 points separating our top two, but there's battles going on throughout the entire top 10 on the overall here in the 2021 season. Next signal we see from Ricky Towery will be a blue flag, which is a dead engine call, and it also signals 30 seconds before the start of the race. There it is. Blue flag is out. Shut them down, shut them down, shut them down, shut them down. And I got to ask you, West Virginia race fans, are you ready to go GNCC racing? Oh, yeah. That's actually pretty good, but I got to tell you, it's been a couple months since we've been out here on the GNCC Tour, and these guys want to hear it. Let's get them amped up. So I'm going to ask you one more time. Are you ready to go GNCC racing? Second, and row number one, the XC1 Pro will be off and rolling at the Rocky Mountain ATV MC Mountaineer GNCC. 250 up for grabs in our whole shot award as our riders barrel down between, oh, it's the number three, Jordan Ashburn, Josh Strang in second, and Ben Kelly opening up in the number three spot here today. As we head down to the XC2 250 Pro, Ryder Lafferty, Benjamin Elko, Cody Barnes, Simon Johnson, Thorne Devlin, Lyndon Snodgrass, Liam Draper, Brody Johnson, Mike Witkowski, Hunter Bush, Brendan Poling, Jesse Ansley, Craig DeLong, Sebastian Tavern, Vincent Smith, Roy Barbosa, Chris Vendetti, and Jonathan Girard in 10 seconds. Good jump off the line, Mike Witkowski and Craig DeLong. DeLong's going to snag it and the early lead as we go to the FMF XC3 125 Pro-Am. Jeremy Lallement, Chase Colville, Noah Clark, Eli Childers, Max Fernandez, Jason Lipscomb, Hunter Newark, Jake Foreman, Jack Joy, Michael Piller, and Jonathan Johnson. 10 seconds. Chase Colville gets a great jump off the line. Eli Childers as well. Let's see, it's the 707 though of Jason Lipscomb. Lipscomb going to get the early lead in this one. Lipscomb out of Parkersburg, West Virginia, AOMC, FX gear, FXR gear, and JDP suspension backed rider. As we go to the open A bike, Nathan Rector, Will Sivenpiper, Dylan Dela Cruz, Tyler Braniff, Ezra Prine, Tyler Soriano, Tanner Whipple, Trail Henderson, Hudson Taylor, Huck Jenkins. 10 seconds. Zachary Hugo, Marshall Fox, Jason Tino, Andy Sibbles, also Johnny Babbitts, James Clark, and Joshua Ellis. Open A class. Number 290. That is Tanner Whipple from Kelowna, Illinois on a Moto Armory Babbitts Motorsports WFO Promotions backed ride as we go to our 250A. JoJo Cunningham, Dakota DeFord, Braden Nolette, Michael DeLosa, Jonathan McDougall, Neil Inman, Zachary Davidson, Bubs Tasha, Gavin Simon. 10 seconds. Benjamin Wright, Bolton Baroth, Alex Luger, Dominic Morris, Troy Vanscourt, George Kowalski, also Logan Krause, Dylan Carano, Joshua Tack, Tristan Lander, Trevor Maley, and Joshua Klocek. 258 rounding that first turn.
And the 356, ooh. Yeah, 356, I think, got that one. It's either him or the 199, but we'll go with Dominic Morris out of Newark Valley, New York on the Ithaca Recreation Sportsback Ride. Four-stroke A lights class coming up next. Tyler Palmer, Cooper Jones, Hayden Dillon, Trevor Getz, Travis Reynaud, Sam Hall, Matthew Davis. 10 seconds. Russell Smith, Mitchell Owenby, Lucas Holt, Joshua Guppy, Kate Henderson, Lane Whitmer, Blaiston Moore, Jason Knopp, and Grant Davis. Grant Davis gets a good drive into that first turn. Let's see what happens. And Davis will walk away with at least the whole shot, at least for the moment. He's got plenty of company coming. It's the 158 class comes up next. Toby Cleveland, Tyler Centrino, Maverick Thaxton, Ryan Piper, Cole Thorne, Sean Myers, Hunter Smith, Blake Kohler, Justin Sisti, Nathan Delaney, and Caleb Baltimore. All set and ready to roll in 10 seconds. For 21, Sean Myers from Reimersburg, Pennsylvania. Good jump off the line, carries it through the first two turns, and now into turn three as we go to the Vent A30 Plus class. Joe Marsh, Nathan Alring, Danny Haftel, Joshua Wyatt, Fabian Barada, Colin Goodman, Andrew Smith, Lorenzo Sanchez, Jared Jordan, Robert Johnson, James Bauer, and Joshua Brown. 10 seconds. Oh, 413, man. Look at that. Oh, 413 sealing the deal there. Jared Jordan on the extreme inside from Cookeville, Tennessee on a Tracing Racing Project Wellness Back Ride. Senior A40 Plus class coming up next. Smiling Frank Messina, Shotgun Sean Remington, also Larry Sylvia, Benny Tomek, Surly Amancio, Alan Peters, Joe Dean, Ignacio Lavosa, Harley Anderson, Darren Darmos, and Jimmy Johnson. And looks like we got Ryder down in our turn there. So we're going to shorten the first turn, guys. Listen up. The short first turn is going to be shortened. They're moving the banner, so you're going to go in between these two flags, the Comedic and 100% banner, it looks like. He's up. That's the good news right there. Going right there. Watch Ricky, guys. Ten seconds. A little alteration in that first turn for safety purposes. And it yields a hole shot for the number 63. Maybe that was the 263 of Fabian Barada from Holly Springs, North Carolina. Senior A40 plus. Actually, I'm sorry. 10 seconds. It's on the wrong class. Here's Junior AB 25 plus, Grant Marriott, Austin Franklin, Tyler Brunton, also Joshua Gibbon, Jeremy Houston, Adam Moffat, Jesse Kildo, Matt Modick, and Andrew Boggs. All right, that 203, Tyler Brunton out of Troutman, North Carolina, grabbing the early lead in this one. To the four-stroke B lights class now, Anthony Blackburn, Hayden Schultz, Trevor Golden, Garrett Mundy, Ty Ely, Thomas Allen, Rayleigh Messer, Xander Garone, Max Grant, Austin Sentinel. 10 seconds. Levi Elliott, Francisco Alvarez, and Caden Sims. .441. Levi. Oh, no. Make that 364. Grabbing the early lead. Rayleigh Messer from Beaver Dam, Kentucky, on board that Yamaha, sneaking that one in. Vet B30 Plus class, Adam O'Dell, Cody Hosta, Larry Hopper, Andreas Brody. 10 seconds. Jorge Garcia, Louis Jacquez, also Nick Plank, David Smith, Michael Funk, Louis Pina, Tyler Click, Nathan Dickey, Brian Rezotarski, Donald Collins, Robert Lanter, Fernando Xavier, Eric Kettering, Bradley Roberts, also Enoch Torres, and Charlie Torazzini. Charlie Torazzini out of Shrewsbury, Massachusetts, happens to be the rider. Went down, but he bounces right back up like he's 12 years old. All right, out to the senior B40 plus class. 10 seconds. Ernie Martin, Brenton Maynard, Adam Nastic, Felipe Branger, William Hollenbeck, Mauricio De Souza, also Ray Hinch and Scott Dowland. Yeah. 9-1-1 of Ray Hinch from Newville, Pennsylvania, grabbing the early lead. 150B, 10 seconds. Hayden Serena, Peyton Gwynn, Matthew Hollenbeck, Nick Barrier, Blaine Barrier, Christopher Eddy, Jay Petard, Aiden Myers, Carter Wendland, Caden Childers, and Brady Weimer. .438, Aiden Myers from Union Grove, North Carolina, Coromoto SR1 suspension 100% goggles, leading them out of that first turn. In the turn two, 250Bs coming up next in 10 seconds. Ethan Dingle, Nick Martin, Tyler Shields, Austin Glass, Vincent Velita, Chandler Taylor, Rodrigo Correa, Ty Hughes, Ryan Miller, Landon Beatty, Dakota Cunningham, Chase Landers, Colton Shields, Brock Belsel, Samuel Goins, Tyler Martin, and Andrew Enman. 429, Charles Landers cutting to the inside out of that first turn out of Monterey, Tennessee, Moose Racing, Husqvarna, Magna One Motorsports back. And the open B in 10 seconds. Dylan Fleming, Miles Gefkin, Austin Hopeatter, John Hawkins, Nicholas Treadway, Landon Rogers, Austin Bruni, Jacob Maynard, Ryan Hymick, Ryan Tucker, Michael Horwat, and Burt Marsiglia. .668 of Landon Rogers from Lumberport, West Virginia on a Smitty's Yamaha with EBC brakes, backed by Enduro 31. And folks, that's going to do it. It's going to wrap up our start here on this Summit Bechtel Preserve. And of course, some 200 plus riders traversing the rocky terrain of almost heaven, West Virginia. Can Stu Baylor make it two in a row here at the Summit itself? Or will Ben Kelly or Josh Toth or someone else? Can Jordan Ashburn pull out a win today? Stick around to find out. GNCC Live continues after this.
I'm Jordan Ashburn, and you're watching GNCC Live at RacerTV.com.
Rocky Mountain ATV MC, retailer, distributor, manufacturer, product developer, parts tester. This is what we do. But who we are is something much simpler. We're riders, like you. 100% employee owned and operated, a company built by riders, entirely for riders. Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
The directive: advance human performance beyond biological mutation.
We'll be right back.
Born of family values and a homegrown work ethic, Kometic Gaskets seals your machine so you can focus on the finish line. Kometic Gaskets are the competitive standard for racers who demand the very best. Kometic Gaskets are constructed from superior materials designed to perform in the most demanding environment. Whether it's championships on the line or a day in the dirt with friends, professionals and enthusiasts depend on Kometic. Kometic Gaskets, sealing championships since 1989.
Amsoil runs on freedom and has since 1972. We changed the industry by formulating the first API-qualified 100% synthetic motor oil. The rest of the market has been trying to follow our lead ever since. But a head start is a head start. We punish our products firsthand in our world-class laboratories and beyond. Because some things can't be learned from a test tube. Run with us.
Last season was my best season ever by far. I won a lot of races, I won a championship, and it was also my first year using ARMA. And one of the things I noticed was just my ability to string good days together. You know, like especially in the summertime in Florida where you're riding every day and the heat index is 108 degrees and you're doing 230s and going to the gym and bicycle and all that stuff. I think in the past I've been super inconsistent day to day. Yeah, I may have a good race here or a good day during the week there, but overall I think where I improved the most was my consistency in my recovery.
This Racer TV broadcast is brought to you by Specialized Turbo E-Bikes. It's you, only faster. And by Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
Good afternoon and welcome back to GNCC Live here on Racer TV. I'm Mikey Waynes. You've already heard from my colleague Rodney Tallman, joined in the booth as always with the Johnny Gallagher. Johnny, how the heck are you, man?
Everything's great, man. Good to be back GNCC racing. You know, what a weekend here at the Mountaineer. Obviously a phenomenal facility. I mean, it's every year coming here, it just kind of puts things in perspective when you realize the scope of just how big this place is. I spent the morning pedaling around during the 10 a.m. race and checking out the near perfect conditions. I mean, the rain last week, I think from that hurricane that came through, just set us up for perfect dirt and mixed in with a whole lot of what you're seeing on the screen there in the background right now, a lot of rocks, and it's going to make for some exciting racing action today, Mikey.
I heard nothing but good things yesterday. As a matter of fact, it seemed like the general consensus this morning was, dude, this was rockier. This was more gnarly than Snowshoe. I don't know how you feel about it. Johnny's nodding, so I'm going to go with he's on board with that.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's different. Snowshoe has a lot of big rocks that you're kind of crawling and climbing over. This place has a lot. I mean, obviously, you can see there's some big rocks. Those people are parked on them, and this guy's lifting his bike through them. But there is also a lot of smaller rocks here that kind of move around, so it makes a challenging race surface. I do think this track was very tough this weekend, but to be completely honest with you, I think it was the best Mountaineer track we've had in the 3 years of coming here, and I think a big reason for that, like I mentioned, the rain the rain they had last week, so really kind of kept the dirt together. Not enough rain to make it muddy by any means, but just kind of kept the consistency of the dirt together, kind of let it pack up, and there was actually some traction out there.
Nice, nice. Well, hey, if you're just joining us, we are going to get you guys, get you a little specialized start recap. Look at our starts for the XC1, XC2, and XC3, starting with, obviously, the XC1. Gnarly starts, by the way, and you get a little sample of just how slick some of this is out here. So jockeying for position, can't miss that bright yellow helmet. Keep your eyes on it on the right-hand side of the screen. He looks to the right, and he cuts off or shuts a door on Josh Strang right there. That's Jordan Ashburn out in front. Strang following behind him, and then Ben Kelly eventually working his way up into that number three spot. Strong start for Benjamin Herrera as well. As a matter of fact, last reports we got, I think he's still somewhere up there in around third place right now. Last reports we got, we'll know more in a second. Taking a look at the XC2 start replay. A dude that needs a win, snagging this one. Numero uno, Craig DeLong, going up and getting it and battling with Mike Wachowski. How many times have we said that in the last couple of years? So those two guys off to a good start. Liam Draper there, right there running in the number three position, at least for the moment. But, boy, good start for Craig DeLong. He needs that, needs a good ride today, needs a win. No doubt about that for the number one Rockstar Husqvarna, a defending champ from 2020. Here in the XC2. And then finally the FMF XC3, the 125s, the sound of our people. Everybody loves the sound of a 125. Ricky Towery with the waving of the green flag. And the 125s duking it out. And it is Jason Liscombe going out and getting it. He's got a couple hole shots on the season, if not a few. Going out and getting this one right here on the 125. We'll see if he can hang on to it, maybe get him a win today. I'm sure he'd love that. Feeling good. Kicking up a little bit of dust right there, Johnny. How was, you know, track conditions? We'll look at the track map here in a second, give you guys an idea. And I know for the ATVs yesterday, this was like what looked like to me old school GNCC. It seemed like 98% of the track was like in the woods. And here you go, the Yamaha Racing track map. Johnny, I'll let you speak more to this as you rode this yesterday.
Yeah, Mikey, you're absolutely right. I mean, this is more of an old school GNCC track. It's definitely got a good speed to it. It's pretty fast, but in the woods, it's, you know, there's not a lot of fields. There's not a lot of opportunities for passing as far as multi-line sections. You kind of get in there and throw some elbows and grind if you want to make a pass. So a lot of rock gardens, a lot of valleys, a lot of ups and downs. And I tell you one thing that, you know, the folks at home watching, or even if, you know, you look at these track maps, these track maps don't show elevation, so it kind of just—it kind of just looks like you got this nice 10-mile track that just goes out. What you don't see is everywhere that you saw kind of those clearings on top. That is the top of a mountain, and it looks like we got a new leader, boys. Stu Baylor on that 514 Ampro Yamaha out front, still the number three of Jordan Ashburn on that Magna One Lubricants Husqvarna there in second. So that's your top two, and they have actually started to open up a little bit of a gap here over our third place rider. Yet to be seen. How about not bit of a gap? How about quite a bit of a gap?
Big, big. So early on, it was Ashburn, Baylor, Herrera, and now it's Baylor, Ashburn.
And here is Ben
there
Kelly.
There we go. There he is, Ben Kelly. So Ben Kelly, not the best start for him. I think he was about middle of the pack. Only nine XC1 guys out there today, by the way. But Ben Kelly, he knows, hey, time's of the essence. All the big talk, Josh Toth, his teammate right behind him there. Obviously, the big talk between Ben Kelly, Stu Baylor. Ben Kelly coming off the win at Snowshoe going into summer break. I felt like he needed that one. He had to get that win to carry a little momentum in here today. But, boy, it's still between those two guys, it's anybody's championship at this point.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, that you know, those guys were really wrestling each other, each wanting to carry that points lead into the long, long summer break. And I think it's been 10 weeks since we've been GNCC racing. And as you mentioned, here is Benjamin Herrera. So not quite up in the top three like he was, but still in touch with that lead group. Unfortunately, you know, the class kind of been ravaged by injuries, and
yeah,
we got some riders not with us this weekend. Only nine riders on that front row, but it's a very fast nine. So
no doubt.
Definitely no lack of talent, just a little weak on the actual numbers themselves. But so this is at the 8-mile marker. This is actually where the morning track would have continued down, and here is still leading the way in XC2. Craig DeLong, right behind him there, the 198 of Liam Draper, and the 282 of Mike Wachowski. So the top three in XC2 are still very much together, pretty much wheel to wheel at this point, Mikey. And, you know, a lap into this one, you know Craig DeLong's up there trying to break away, but those guys are just not letting him go. Stu Baylor and Jordan Ashburn have been able to break away in that XC1 class. And there is Johnny Girard. So there is your XC2 points leader. And it looked like he was about fourth off the start. So he's kind of been there all along. Ryder Lafferty, Ben Nelko. Not sure who that was there. Looked like maybe another gas rider. Could have been a Honda. That could have been Rui Barbosa. So Rui, a rider out of Chile, riding for that Phoenix Racing Honda. You know, he's been putting a lot of time during the offseason doing some Mideast races with Josh Strang and Lyndon Snodgrass and that group down there. We'll wait and watch here. We got some people looking like they're getting excited and some clapping. Some Stu Baylor fans, and there is the man out front, Stu Baylor. And he's opened up just a little bit of a gap over Ashburn, but Ashburn's still there in his shadow. And that's the big thing, Mikey, at this point in the race. You know, Stu is so good at getting to the front early. And, wow, we got a party going
party
on
poppers.
On the
hey,
trail.
Let's
party
go.
Poppers. Yeah, hey, can't beat it. So the nine-mile marker, these yeah, guys, are, like we said, have already distanced themselves from the third-place ride, which is this man right here, Ben Kelly. So Ben looking like he's got a little bit of sense of urgency, probably got some pit boards that those guys have gotten away. And here is his teammate, the 207, Josh Toth. We could see the glare from the sunlight there. So that's one thing I did struggle with yesterday personally, and I heard a lot of riders say it's pretty dark in sections of the woods. So it's definitely challenging to try to, Josh Toth, always with style, on the rear wheel, balancing that KTM and putting on a show for the fans.
It's funny he did that. Well, not funny. I mean, that's how he is, Josh Strang right there. But we talked about that this morning. Josh Toth, what was it, Snowshoe, that first lap, about how great his form was, how meticulous and almost perfect he was through there. And here he is. He said, I heard you guys. I'm going to put on a little show for the cameras here today, too.
There was actually some comments about the one lap that we pointed out when he wasn't
perfect. Oh, right. Yes, exactly.
You know, so, but hey, man, if we're going to give you compliments, we're also going to call you out. You know, just because you're 3 hours in doesn't mean you're allowed to dab. That's not how this works. So, yeah, we saw Josh Strang, Lane Michael, Trevor Bollinger, and Thad Duvall all have now worked their way through this shot here at the FMF PowerPoint at the nine-mile marker. The last of the XC1 guys, there he is, Rui Barbosa. So that is your ninth place rider in XC1. The top nine are through. The next rider we'll be waiting on is that factory rock star, Husqvarna, of Craig DeLong, the number one machine. And he should be coming here just about any moment, leading the way in that XC1. We saw him last. It was the 198 of Liam Draper, pretty much in his shadow, and then right behind him. So there is DeLong still leading the way. Looks like he's opened up maybe a little bit over Draper. But not too much. There is Draper, and then the third place ride of, look at this.
Johnny Girard
has gotten around Witkowski and putting in a charge, made up some time there. So Girard, a little bit of, a push to try and get himself up into touch with that lead group. Doesn't want to let those guys get away. Lap number one complete, and it is the 514 Stu Baylor leading the way through and looking good in that new Moose Racing gear on that AmPro Yamaha, bringing out their 2022 stuff. Everybody showing off their good stuff this weekend. Hopping that little ditch, and he is off to begin lap number two. Jordan Ashburn still right there, though, shadowing him, able to key off him. See the lines he's using, see the pace, and, you know, Mikey, we've talked about this so much. It's so much easier to follow somebody than it is to lead. So right now, Jordan Ashburn really in the catbird seat.
Yeah, that's it. That's it right there. You know, Ashburn is one of those guys we were talking about. Extremely consistent, and that's why he has the success that he does. But when's he going to turn that corner and get that first W there in the overall? Taking a look at timing and scoring, Stu Baylor up when he checked in about 4 seconds ahead of Jordan Ashburn. And I give you the rest of the breakdown here. My computer's wanting to play some games with me right now. But
you got to wonder, did you catch that? As Stu was coming down the VP Fuels Pro Row, he leaned up over the front of his machine, wiped off his number plate, and tapped it. So you wonder what that was about. Was there some, you know, Stu's always got a seemingly to have a little message or a little motivation of some kind. So maybe a little something about showing off that 514, showing off the front number plate, maybe clean because he's leading. I don't know.
Could be.
He did a wipe with the hands of the number plate, and then he tapped it. There is Josh Toth. They're still in that fourth place spot, and he has grabbed a little splash of water there. So he's getting himself hydrated for the long race ahead.
So there you go. Your top eight have checked in. Stu Baylor out front, Ashburn second, Ben Kelly in that number three spot. His teammate Josh Toth in the number four position. The 114 Babbitt's Online Monster Energy Kawasaki ride of Strang in fifth. Lane Michael back in the number six position with Trevor Bollinger in seventh. And Thad Duvall rounding out your top eight in the XC1. Let's take a look here. Come on, computer. Play nice with me. Play nice. Let's see if we can see the XC2. We'll let it think. There it goes. So the XC2 should be checking in here in a moment if they have not already.
There is Stu heading along one of the very few spots of trail here where you actually can kind of take a little breather. A little dusty through there if you're behind, but when you're in the lead, that's about the smoothest this place gets. Got a couple little ditches, but then dip back into the woods here. He's got a quick little woods, couple chicanes of woods, and then back out to another section of field, and then into the, that's when the rocks start.
That's when the rocks start.
It's about 9 miles later is when the rocks end. Woof. So it looks as though Ben Kelly might be making tracks. He might be making inroads into closing that gap up. Not that it's a huge gap, but I think he knows that Stu Baylor is way too dangerous to let him get out front, check out, get comfortable, get himself a nice 45-minute lead plus, and at that point, he is completely in control of the race. He's controlling it from the front now, but he does still have a shadow of Jordan Ashburn, and again, Ben Kelly not all that far behind there. So he's definitely opened it up a little bit over Ashburn there. We'll see what the gap is when we look back. Yeah, he's coming. He's getting closer. Definitely getting closer to Ashburn, and I think even maybe making up a little bit of ground on Stu here at the start of lap number two.
Ben Kelly on the move, taking a look at that XC2 class. We'll have more XC1 guys coming through the Monster Mile here. Craig DeLong out front. Johnny Girard did move into that number two spot. Liam Draper in third, and Mike Bukowski sitting in the number four position right now. Toth on screen on the move, trying to keep up the pace of his teammate out in front of him.
And that's kind of a good telling thing there. You know, when we last saw, Toth was right on Kelly, and now Kelly has quite a decent little gap there. Now, there's some guys here down below. Lane Michael actually trying to make the pass on Josh Trang, taking the low line there. And it looks like, is that Trevor, or is that, that was actually Thad that did make the pass on Trevor Bollinger. So those guys shuffling it up, shaking it up. That is your fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth place guys there, all very much together. And I feel like there's going to be a lot of that kind of action through the Rock Gardens to come for the next 9 miles.
That's right. So this little split line section, I did see some good footage yesterday of, I believe it was Walker Fowler, taking a different line here at the Monster Mile and coming wheel to wheel with a rider. So maybe we got a little bit of that here today, maybe some handlebar to handlebar. It's definitely gnarly, that's for sure. I think we've actually, Johnny, you were talking about Stu Baylor coming through the pro pits there, tapping on that front number plate. I think we've actually got maybe a close-up shot, at least a little replay, give you an idea of what that looked like. What is the message Stu is sending right here?
Yeah, he's cleaning it off a little bit, and then he gives her a little tap, like, hey, just so you guys know. Oh.
You might be right. Adam Gordon said, we think he might be pointing at the number one.
Oh, interesting. Well, that would definitely be a little bit of a flex there. leading lap number one, pointing at the one, so.
Careful, Johnny. Every time we doubt Stu, he comes
I'm
out.
I'm not doubting him. Okay, I'm simply relaying what Adam Gordon said, which is they think it may be a point at the one. You know, Stu's never short of personality, never short of attitude for sure. So. Oh, really? Okay. We're told that Jet Lawrence did something like that possibly yesterday. Maybe covered up the eight to make it look like the one after he wrapped up that championship in the Pro Outdoor Motocross yesterday at Hangtown there. Ryder Lafferty hanging tough. So those, it looks like that XC2 battle's tightening up. We got four guys pretty much nose to tail there.
So out of the XC2, I think, you know, Liam Draper, Mike Bukowski, those two guys battling up front with them, those are two guys that need a good ride.
Yeah.
And I mean, we're in silly season at this point with the four rounds left. It's kind of that put up or shut up time for those guys. I want to prove to my sponsors, my team, I want to prove it to myself that I'm still that guy. I'm still capable of going out and competing for wins.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what it takes this, you know, at this point. And here is Lyndon Snodgrass, another rider that we saw some great things out of earlier in the season. A little further back, I'm sure, than he would like to be right now, back in about that eighth or ninth place spot even. And then it looks like we got to, oh, one of the Trail Jesters riders down. Not sure if that's Jesse Ansley or if that is Jesse Ansley on the 328 machine down. Having a little bit of a struggle getting that machine refired down in the rocks and on his way. The struggles early here in lap number two for that rider back outside the top 10 in that XC2 Pro Lights class.
Rolling right along, taking a look at that FMF XC3. Those guys should be checking in here in a moment to the Monster Mile. And who's out front? Who else? Jonathan Johnson leading the way. Chase Colville sitting in that number two spot. And Jake Froman sitting in third. Jason Liscomb, who snagged that whole shot, sitting back in fourth. And Michael Piller back rounding out the top five in that FMF XC3.
There he is on screen. Jonathan Johnson leading the way in that XC3 right on cue. Looking like he's got a pretty comfortable little lead. Nobody right there on his rear wheel. So he's got a little bit of breathing room, and we'll see if this looks to be maybe Jay Lipscomb there. Nope, that is actually Chris Vendetti, an XCT rider there. And then Chase Colbert in the second place spot in XC3. So your top two in XC3 by here at the 1 mile marker.
Chase Colville, one of those dudes, like early on the season, he just, the whole shot was automatic for him. And I kept thinking, man, when is Colville going to put that full race together, that full 3 hours of battle for wins for Jonathan Johnson? But boy, it's Bennett. Not a replay, just kidding. But hey, there's the bike of Rachel Archer, who took the win earlier today in the WXC. Should have an interview coming up with her later this afternoon. Just kidding, just kidding.
Hi, guys.
Hi, Rodney Tomlin. Welcome back to the booth. How you doing?
I'm doing all right. It's nice to be out. I mean, I tell you, it is such a beautiful day. But that, wow, that sun, pretty intense whenever you're not used to it.
Actually, beautiful day out there today. I mean, we saw temperatures, I think, what, in the mid to upper 70s yesterday. We're looking at lower to mid 80s today, so just a little bit warmer as... So I jump in. What's been going on, guys? Anything exciting?
Stu Baylor's out front. Stu Baylor's covering up numbers, or, you know.
I heard you guys talking about that. And whenever you made the analogy. That,
one more time for Rod.
One more time for everybody in the back.
Okay.
There it is. Now we're on the same page. Here you go, Rodney. Stu Baylor coming through. Letting them know. Look at that numero.
He's just saying, look how clean it is. I think your analogy was right, Johnny, when you said that it's a clean number plate and I'm up front. May have been what he was trying to say. And wow, what? It looks like he's already, at least in that shot, commanding control of what's going on as far as this race is concerned. Jordan Ashburn, when they checked in, was right there 4 seconds behind him. So, and you know, these are conditions that Jordan Ashburn, does he like the rocks, Johnny Gallagher?
We know Jordan likes the mud.
There it is.
In case you guys didn't know, Jordan does like the mud. But Jordan likes the rocks. I mean, Jordan's from Tennessee. Jordan chooses to go out of his own accord and do races like the Tennessee Knockout and some races like that that are known to be technical, a lot of rocks, a lot of throttle control. So he's very good in these conditions. We've seen him thrive at places like Somerset before.
Right.
Nearly won a race there. Would have been actually his first race win when he was riding for that Ampro Yamaha team a number of years ago. Led all day. And I believe Caleb Russell ran him down in the final turns, made the pass. But, you know, rocky, slick conditions and did incredibly well there. So not surprised to see him up front. We've seen him run up front in these kind of conditions before, and always a threat for a podium is Jordan.
Yeah, I hate to say it, but probably one of the most overlooked riders on my part personally. There's Stu Baylor checking in at the Method Race Wheels Method Alley, and I totally apologize for that for him all the time, and I keep telling myself make mental notes not to do that, but somehow or another I do. And what is always so cool is that he's always there. And there he is again, checking in the number two spot. We're probably looking at more of a little 10-plus second lead that Stu's got over the field now as we look back to that third-place position. It was 20 seconds at the finish line between Ben Kelly and Jordan Ashburn in that second-place position.
Yeah, and we actually saw that gap had tightened up quite a bit in our last camera shot, and now it has opened up again. So we don't know if Ben Kelly's gone down or if Stu Baylor picking up the pace up front has caused Jordan Ashburn to chase after him, but now this is quite a bit opened up here. I mean, it was down under 10 seconds in our last camera shot, and it's well up over 20, maybe pushing 30 now at this point.
Josh Toth back in the number four spot. There is Kelly checking in, and yeah, we're well over, I think, in that 30-second range. And there is Josh Toth now starting to reel him in, it looks like. And for some reason, and I'm thinking, you know, I said it, I think, before the break, I think that Josh Toth is due to start clicking some pretty good rides off, and I think he's got a win or two that he could probably click off as well. And I was talking who was that there?
Thad Duvall's made some passes. Yeah. He was all the way back in eighth and is now all the way up to that fifth place spot. So he's made a couple spots up there. Those guys all still very much together, including Bollinger, Lane Michael, Josh Trang, and Thad are all together. But he has made the pass on all of those guys.
Yeah.
And now he is maybe trying to make a run to get up there with Ben Kelly and Josh Toth and battle over that final podium spot.
Continuing that thought on Josh Toth, I was talking with Ryan Eccles, and Ryan said that, you know, he was putting his money kind of on Josh today and just seeing what his mindset was just walking the track. He says, I have never seen
Josh Toth, as lighthearted and as easygoing as what he was there on the track walk that I saw him on yesterday. He says, I would expect that Josh is going to do very well. And Ryan even said, hey, he might even be a winner today.
Yeah, it's getting to that point, I think, for Josh Toth. And I think if he's smiling, that's a good thing. He's riding, he's loose, he feels good. And I think this is a track that if you were to ask Josh Toth, it suits him.
Yeah.
We were talking a moment ago, Rodney, about that first lap there at Snowshoe when he came through Howard's Hole. Craig DeLong on screen still leading the way, but boy, knocking on the door is Johnny Girard
right there
in that number two spot. So we'll see who is in third. Earlier was, I believe, Liam Draper and Mike Wachowski battling for it. So looking for that 198. No, there he is. There was Mike Wachowski. So Liam Draper right behind him. I think that was Benjamin Herrera in between them. So flip-flopping back and forth there. Mike Wachowski, another guy, needs a good ride, as does Liam.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely, you know, and that's what they're all in search for. And that's the thing about it. These guys, you know, the competition is so stiff. They're each other's competition. Each one of them needs to get a good ride, and each one of them are doing their best to make it happen. And, of course, the big question is, who is going to make it happen? Who's going to come out on top of this one today in any of these classes and the overall? Can Stu Baylor command this control to the end? Stick around to find out. GNCC Live continues on RacerTV.com.
I'm Stuart Baylor. You're watching GNCC Live on RacerTV.com.
Honor, dignity, service to others, and respect. During unprecedented times, first responders across the nation are working hard to keep us and our families safe. This week, we take time to pay homage to these selfless individuals across the nation, the ones putting their lives on the line every day for our freedom. First responders, the GNCC Racing Nation owes you it all. From the bottom of our heart, thank you.
Even when you're the best, you never stop striving to be better. With over 40 years of experience in motorcycle sales and service, we know racing. Our inventory of Yamaha motorcycles, sport bikes, dirt bikes, ATVs, and side-by-sides is extensive and constantly changing. Stop by LoJack Cycle Sales today in Tarentum, Pennsylvania, and visit our online inventory at www.lojacks.com. Yamaha YZs. It's why we ride.
Hi, my name is Andrea Lee, the director of On Track School. How would you like to go to a school where we take into consideration how students learn best? Well, we do that because we find if we can build the curriculum around the things you are interested in, you're going to do a better job. The mission at On Track School is that educational success is possible while chasing your dreams. Not only will our staff help students to achieve success, they will cheer you on to the finish line. We encourage you to check out On Track School at ontrackschool.com, where we can help you chase your dreams and still get a quality education.
We are American Motorcyclists. We are members of the American Motorcyclist Association. Racers, fans, and crew, we come together for this sport we love, to race together, to grow together. We start young and not so young. We race motorcycles and ATVs. We become friends. We become family.
We compete for weekend bragging rights and national championships. We make memories on the toughest off-road courses in the country and on the best motocross tracks in the world. Some of us aspire to the speed and poise of road racing or the fierce competitiveness of American flat track. And we honor our greatest champions in the AMA Motorcycle Hall of Fame. Through it all, we cheer. We win and we lose. We are racing. We are the AMA. Race with us. Be part of the greatest sport in the world. Be an American motorcyclist. Join us today at www.amajoy.com/join-now.
Brown's RV Superstore is family-owned and operated and staked their reputation on offering you the finest RVs available in their McBee, South Carolina RV dealership. Brown's RV Superstore carries motorhomes, fifth wheels, travel trailers, and toy haulers, and keep a huge inventory of new and used RVs in stock for you to choose from. They offer top dollar for your RV trade-in and help you get the RV financing you need. As a part of the GNCC family, Brown's RV Superstore, in partnership with Vengeance Toy Haulers, offer sponsorship packages for every level of racer with discounts and continued savings on your new toy hauler. Brown's RV Superstore has dedicated themselves to complete customer satisfaction, specializing in providing a positive start to your RV adventure. They look forward to customers coming back to share their tales from the road. Call Brown's RV Superstore today at 877-805-3658 or visit their website at brownsrvsuperstore.com, where family fun begins.
It was long, let me tell you. I don't know, for some reason it felt longer than usual. 2 months we had, and it was good. Seemed like the first time I kind of stayed home and had a handful of off weekends to just relax, not ride, and just hang out at home, so that was nice. But I did a handful of races. I think I did like 3 local races and then had 2 national enduros where I had good finishes. So, had a really solid summer break. I'm feeling good, better than I have all year. So just out here, really excited to get back racing GNCC.
Man, summer break was long. You know, it felt longer than normal. I didn't, this year I haven't had to do any other races besides GNCC. So I took a couple weeks off from the dirt bike and just did some family stuff. We went to the beach for a couple of days and had some fun, and then pretty much just kind of back into it. It's been for 6 to 8 weeks there in North Carolina. Was really hot, so to do much riding, I was getting out early and trying to do some riding, and then for the rest of the day just trying to stay inside. And you stay too long out in the heat and you end up just wearing yourself down over the time. So just trying to enjoy summer, had some fun with friends, family and everything, and then the last month or so we've been fairly hard at it, so getting ready to come back racing here today.
And welcome back to Beckley, West Virginia. Good to catch up with the riders from the summer break. A lot of them keeping pretty busy. I know Johnny Gallagher stayed pretty busy. By the way, Johnny, didn't get a chance to congratulate you on your win that you took this summer. But congratulations on the win, ATV race win. I know he was racing against all the top GNCC pros, too. He won't even comment on that.
Well, it was. I mean, it was a regional race, an E-Rock Series race, so I ended up being a pretty good payday and a good day for me. So
there you go.
I'll take it. You know, obviously, I would prefer if I was going to pull off one of those, kind of rabbit out from the hat type wins, I'd rather it be at a GNCC. But nonetheless, it's still good to get out there, bang bars with those guys, and grab a win. So yeah.
Congratulations to you. But yeah, I mean, a lot of things, a lot of people doing a lot of things over the summer break, but a lot of guys staying very busy. I know that several people going to the ISDE, as we have probably mentioned a few times, the WMX rider Rachel Goodish, who was a part of the the women's ISD Team USA, and they took the overall championship there. So world champion Rachel Guttisch, and proud to have her as a part of our GNCC racing family as well.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the women killed it over there. Brandi Richards from California, or actually Arizona. But West Coast girl actually made history and won every single test, including the final moto, over 6 days of racing.
Wow. She's
never even been close to done. So that would be 30 tests plus the final moto. Stu Baylor on screen, the 514. Ampro Yamaha out front and stretching the lead over the number three Magna One's lubricant of Jordan Ashburn. We'll see if it is still Ashburn in second. We expect it to be. That gap had opened up to, as Rodney, you pointed out, 10 plus seconds. Whoa, not anymore. That's a little less. So Ashburn putting in a charge has actually closed up the gap, and this could be the reason why they're starting to get into lapped riders out here on this very, very, very technical mountaineer track.
Well, let's talk about this hill climb right here at the 8 mile marker. If you're looking at it, the camera, now we're starting to see that, you know, it's quite a bit of a challenge. But again, cameras don't do it justice, Johnny. This particular part of the track right here is unique in its way. You know, you're coming in, you got two different lines that come into this, and then you got this one single line up, but you got rocks that are starting to be more and more exposed, roots that are becoming more and more exposed, and there's a lot of places out here on this trail like this.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's a challenging section of racetrack. Obviously, Ben Kelly and the top riders make it look easy, but that is very steep. Let me tell you, having e-biked up that a couple times this weekend, that is incredibly steep section of race course. Here comes the 207 of Josh Toth. Always with the style, always with the proper riding mechanics. Oh, he did do a little two dabs on that hill, but there was a lapped rider, so he gets a pass.
Actually, it's the 206. He does have 207 on his jersey, but I thought that was funny when you said that, because his jersey says 207, and I still think of him as 207, but his actual number is 206.
Interesting, yeah.
We noticed that on the starting line today. We got kind of a chuckle out of that one today.
Wonder what happened there. That's
same thing. Somebody was thinking the same way we were,
yeah.
I guess.
All right, 207 it is. Yeah. Well, 206.
But, yeah, and again, you know, this, you know, getting back to why I was talking about this, the track breaking down the way it is, this is where these races start to tighten up. Is that Duval now?
That Duval there in the fifth place spot. Here is Lane Michael, the 523. On that Ampro Yamaha there in sixth, and Josh Strang in seventh. So your top seven through at the 8 mile marker, and you can see just how challenging that hill climb is. These lapped riders really starting to struggle. Trevor Bollinger now is going to have to navigate his way through these lapped riders. Trevor had a nice little angle line last lap, and it works out for him again. You can see that shows you just how steep it is.
Yeah.
You know, that's near vertical. It doesn't look to be that steep until you try to take a dirt bike up it, and then you see just how steep it actually is.
And there's some of the roots exposed. You know, it looks like it doesn't look as gnarly as what I had expected it to look, especially watching the ATVs traverse different parts of this track yesterday. I saw, you know, a lot of that, what seemed almost virgin, in a sense, really changed the face of the surface changed a lot throughout the course of the 2 hours of racing. As we pick up with Stu Baylor again here at the 9 mile marker now, the FMF PowerPoint. I know there were some changes made over in this section.
I tell you what, Rodney, you saw Stu kind of get a little held up by that lapped rider, and I really think that could be a big part of why we've seen Jordan Ashburn really close that gap up. You know, we had seen it was well over 10 seconds, and now I'd say it's five or less. He's virtually right back to the rear wheel. We'll wait and we'll watch for the 530 FMF Red Bull KTM of Ben Kelly, and there he is. And then it would be the 206-207 of Josh Toth in the number fourth play, or in the number four spot. And there is Kelly working his way down through this FMF PowerPoint. And as you mentioned, this section, very technical. It's got a couple of different lines through it. And if you miss your mark, you can lose a lot of momentum through that section.
Yeah, and there's a lot of sections after talking with folks. You know, they say there's a lot of rocks. You're either going uphill, you're going downhill, you're going off camber, or you're going through a rock garden. In an uphill, downhill, or in off camber.
Yeah, we were talking that a little bit about that earlier when we were looking at the track map. You know, when you look at the two-dimensional track map, it just appears to be kind of this big loop that goes out through some nice rolling forests. What you don't see is just how much elevation change there is at a place like this. You know, West Virginia, known for the mountains, and we're right in the thick of it here, man. You know, so many valleys and creeks down in the bottoms and up these very, very steep hillsides. So it really limits exactly what they can do with the track. If you compare the track map for this track to many throughout the year, there's not as much inside loop, I guess right. You would say. And that's just because, man, they're just going where they can when they're laying this track out. And then it just gets tougher as the weekend goes on. Thad Duvall, West Virginia native, hometown boy, out there pushing and up to the fifth place spot. He has put a little bit of time between himself and this man right here, the 523 of the Ampro machine of Lane Michael, fresh back from Italy himself, and his teammate on screen now, the 514 of Stu Baylor, out front leading the way and trying to open up a gap over the number three of Jordan Ashburn. Ashburn had closed it up a good bit. Stu taking a look over his shoulder. Did we lose Ashburn? Because he was much closer in the last camera shot. Got to wonder if those lappers are starting to work in the opposite way he has. He's definitely lost some ground. You can see the lappers kind of racing him there. And that's where things get interesting, man. When you're trying to run the pace that the top XC1 guys are, a lot of times you can't blame the lap riders. They're not expecting you. You're just kind of coming up on them out of nowhere. They think it's somebody in their class that they're racing. But it's just that situational awareness type thing where, you know, as an XC1 guy, you have to assume that they don't know it's you, and you got to make sure you pick a good, safe spot to try and make a pass on those guys. And there is Corey McDonald with a little pit board. Not sure what that said. Maybe a little inspirational message for Stu. He's pretty well led this one from about halfway through lap one, and here he is down the long side of BP Fuel Pro Row. And working his way into the XC2 auxiliary pits and out through and right back into this one little dusty section. We were talking about this a little bit earlier, Rodney. This really is the only dusty section of racetrack from here along this top section of pits. You know, the wind, the sun has kind of dried the soil out here, but as we see in the woods, really good moisture in the track this weekend.
Yeah, that's one thing I was noting. And, you know, I don't know that this has necessarily been a wetter year than in years past, but the mountains have certainly held their moisture for us leading into this Indian summer, heading into fall, of course, and I think it's made for perfect conditions, honestly. I mean, it's the tracks broke down, you know, in a consistent manner, some way you can expect it to break down, and I think that's helped the racing out.
Yeah, it has. And we talked about this a little bit earlier. I think from what I'd heard from some people that are somewhat local to the area here, I think they got kind of the outlying storm cell that came through that was the cause of that hurricane last week. And that is what brought a lot of the moisture up here to this area. So I don't think it was torrential downpours or anything, but it was enough of a sustained rain over a course of a couple of days that it really gave the soil a good soaking and, allowed the dirt to stay together better for the weekend and has really given us a great racing surface throughout the nearly 2 days complete now of racing. This is our last race for the weekend, and the boys are going to do all the damage they can to the dirt because they want to they want to get all they can out of their machines.
I tell you, Johnny, when we came here the first time a few years ago with high anticipations of what to expect, we didn't know what to expect. What a beautiful facility. And though it is challenging in its own rights as far as laying out the course for the track crew, and the course itself is challenging, man. I mean, it gets us back to the roots of GNCC. It's kind of even a one-off. I mean, even when you compare it to Snowshoe and things like that, I think it's got its uniqueness here in the mountains of West Virginia, even more so than what maybe Snowshoe does.
Yeah, it does. Snowshoe, we've talked about it a number of times. It has a kind of a feast or famine when it comes to the track. You know, there's sections that are incredibly technical, challenging, get dug out and muddy and slick. Some of, without question, something like Howard's Hole is kind of the gnarliest of the gnarly that gets thrown at us as racers or these guys throughout the course of the entire 13-round series. But then a lot of Snowshoe, just because the terrain is so gnarly, the only way to get from point A to point B is kind of access. Oh, look at this. We've got a rider in VP Fuels Pro Row. Is that Josh Strang? That appears to be Josh Strang. It is. Like, and Josh, is something we have seen so often this year. Josh Strang putting the bike on the stand in the Babbitt's Monster Energy Online Kawasaki pits. And he is relaying some information. Not sure what they're working on. They got the T-handles out. Looks like they're trying to take the shroud off that machine. So something going on the left-hand side of the machine. Don't know if that was caused by a crash, impact of the lapper, or mechanical failure. But I'm sure we'll get Mikey Waynes over there and get an update if we can. Man, heartbreaker for Josh Drang. And looking at his results this year, that's something, you know, as mentioned, we've just seen far too much of this year. You know, when you're spending that much time in the pits, you can't be out on the racetrack doing what you need to do, which is make the radiator.
Yeah.
So you gotta believe that's crash or impact of some kind related.
It's especially heartbreaking knowing, you know, seeing the races that we've seen out of Josh this year, knowing how deep he's dug and in a lot of events to get some of the stellar results that he has been able to get when he's getting them. And to see the obstacles that he has to face and the mountains he has to climb, it is frustrating. Even from a fan standpoint, I think, of Josh Drang, they've got to be kind of frustrated at a particular point also. And, you know, that's just the nature of the game, Johnny. I mean, you know, sometimes, you know, you have good years and nothing goes wrong. And then there's that one year that where it seems like no matter how good you are physically, how good you feel physically, how well you ride, it's just there's always something that seems to happen that kind of pulls the rug out from under the whole thing.
Yeah, and I think the key in a situation like this is, you know, we've seen the visible frustration from Josh Strang a few times earlier this year when the bike very clearly let him down. But at the same time, I think he has a very close relationship with this team, with this group of people around him, with his mechanic, Joe Maurer, with the team manager, Fred Andrews, and the entire crew there at the Babbitt's Kawasaki rig. And I think, you know, he believes in them and understands that sometimes things happen. And on a day like today, I don't know, but we're going to speculate. Radiator being replaced, that's going to be from contact of some kind, whether it be with the lap rider, you know, with the ground. Speculation. We don't know this for a fact. But something caused that radiator to burst. Most likely it was contact or damage. And on a day like today, you know, those guys are going to stand behind Josh as their rider, just like he stands behind them. Sometimes when, you know, when the machine maybe has failed him, you know, he's still right there and pushing. And as soon as they have that machine ready, he'll be back out on the track giving it his all. So, you know, Josh is a former champion of the series, multi-time race winner, incredibly talented, incredibly resilient. You know, I think a number of years ago, people were saying, oh, well, Josh is probably just riding out his final couple years. And then he started talking about, you know, how much fun he was having riding his dirt bike and racing. And suddenly we saw these results just pouring in, the wins, the podiums. You know, it was like he could do no wrong. And as you pointed out, the momentum can swing in both directions.
Yeah.
And right now it's like Josh Drang can't win for losing. So, you know, we'll hope that maybe this is the last of the gremlins and the hiccups in his 2021 campaign. You know, maybe he can use this for fuel and come back. But it would be easy to say Josh is out in terms of, you know, scoring points today. But, man, some of the comeback rides he's had so far in 2021,
exactly,
outside the top 40, outside the top 50, coming back to at or near inside the top 10. So it's early enough in the race yet. We still got 2 hours of racing left to go.
I believe Mikey Waynes may be standing by now with an update and report. Mikey, have you got anything for us?
Yeah, hey, guys, just down here with Josh Strang. He's cool, he's calm, he's collected. I said, hey, you want a powwow? He said, yeah, sure, I can do it. Josh, we talked earlier today. We were talking about a shoey. I don't know the shoey's going to happen for you today, man. But you're in good spirits right now.
Yeah, no shoey today. We got three more races, though, and three tracks that I look forward to, so... how about we'll save it to one of those, or maybe all three. That would be nice.
There you go, man. Well, hey, head up. Keep her going. We'll see if we can get Josh Strang out here on the track. We're going to walk around, see if we can't get with Rachel Archer in a moment, talk to her about that WXC win coming up next.
All righty. Thanks a lot, Mikey. So that's a plus and a positive because, like you pointed out there a few moments ago, we've seen Josh at times visibly upset. I think it's cool. He's taking it in stride and still looking forward to wins through the next three rounds of racing.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think attitude is everything, both good and bad. I think when you come in with a positive outlook on a situation, you're more likely to obviously you have to put in the work, you have to do the riding, but when you come in with a positive attitude, you're more likely to have a positive takeaway at the end of the weekend. There's Josh's teammate, I believe. That was the 178 of Lyndon Snodgrass. There is some more XC2 guys coming by. Simon Johnson, Ben Nelko. Man, these guys are just smashing their way through the rocks and through lapped riders. And I think, Rodney, we were talking a little bit ago about how just you can't really see how much elevation change there is and just how gnarly this place is in terms of. And I think they've actually got, you can see, you can talk about exactly what we're looking at here, right?
Yeah, I mean, you're looking at anywhere from, what, 1,826 feet, I think, is what we start out at.
Yep.
We go up to as high as, what is that?
It looks like it's a little over 2,000.
2301.
So 500 feet elevation change may not seem like a lot, but look at the number of times it makes these changes.
Yeah.
You know, so this is not
up, down, then up a little more, then down, and up a little bit. Yeah.
So if you look here, show me how many times where it looks like you're going flat for very long. You know, there isn't other than up, you know, near the top here, you see a couple spots where you're kind of in or near the pits where you got some straightaways. But other than that, it's literally you're either going up or you're going down.
Is the 7.5 near that 6 to points where we – is that the big long downhill that he was talking
about?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Oh, it's huge. I mean, you start at – you're pretty much up. You can see you there around the – 6.75, just before that, about the 6.5. You're up at the highest point on the course, and you're actually at one point pop out of the woods, and you can see, you know, just how high you are. And then from there, you kind of turn just past kind of that 8 mile marker is where you really start to fall in elevation, and you just kind of just keep coming down and down and down and down, and it seems like it never ends.
Well, Josh Strang looks like he's getting ready to get back on. No end in sight, at least right now for him, as he's getting ready to jump back on that. Team Babbitt's Monster Energy Kawasaki machine. As we take a look at our standings right now, again, Stu Baylor leading Jordan Ashburn, Ben Kelly back in the number three spot. Our official gaps as they came through the finish line there just a few moments ago. Let's see here. There we go. All right. It was 12 seconds between first and second. So let's see if we're still in that 12-second range. Has Jordan Ashburn been able to make up some time? Has he lost any time?
Well, it seems a little less than 12 seconds. Yeah. I'd say it's so the tail of the rubber band tape is still kind of playing out here. It seems like they each have some sections of the course where they're faster. Josh Strang back out on track and going to head out in search of trying to clamber back some of those valuable points that you get for finishing in the top 20 overall. So it's going to be a long day of making a lot of passes for Josh Strang, but, you know, as we pointed out, a great attitude, having fun on his dirt bike, and he's going to go out and see what he can do.
Ben Kelly, 33 seconds back at the end of lap number two, and I'm going to have to say that gap looks like it's opening up even more, and that lends me to wonder whether or not Josh Toth is able to bridge any of the 28-second gap that lies between he and Kelly now for that third-place position.
We were kind of keeping an eye on that on lap one. It seemed like Josh Toth was right on Ben Kelly's rear wheel, and then all of a sudden Ben had made that big jump up and got nearly to the rear wheel of Jordan Ashburn and kind of inside of Stu Baylor, and it was a good 20, 25 seconds back to Toth the next time we saw him. And then the very next camera shot, Ben had dropped all that time back and then some. Oh, and Ben Kelly having an issue there, shaking his head and looking at something on the right side. Almost looked like he was messing with his watch, possibly. Don't know if maybe his Garmin was acting up and been pinching him, or maybe he forgot to start it and he wanted to make sure that he got his heart rate data so he could have his cookies after the race. That is definitely not 25 seconds back to Josh Toth. So again, kind of seems to be when Ben struggles, Josh is able to pull back up to the rear, and unfortunately for Ben, that gap to Jordan Ashburn continuing to grow, it looks like.
Yes, for sure. And a solid day for Stu and both Jordan up there right now. I mean, pretty impressed with what Jordan's doing. Like we said, he's keeping pretty close. There is Thad Duvall in that number five spot. He was about 37 seconds, so probably right around that same time frame, around 30 seconds still.
Don't sleep on that guy. You know, he's won a lot of GNCC races. Obviously, it's been a rough year for Thad Duvall, but we've been waiting and wondering when is, you know, the bad Thad
right
that we've seen so many times going to start showing his hand here. And it seems like maybe looking at the gap that he's opened up over Lane Michael, and obviously, you know, Josh Strang kind of retired from the race there temporarily, but there is Trevor Bollinger now up into the sixth place spot. So he has also gotten around Lane Michael and another rider that was in that battle, Josh Strang, obviously, when he dropped back. So that is your top six through.
Yeah, so I'm looking for the number one. There's Lane Michael coming through now. But I'm looking for Craig DeLong and Jonathan Girard to check in on here in just a few moments. I know they were pretty close when we saw them in the last time around. 2 seconds is what they were when they came through the finish line. So these guys have been riding pretty closely knit for a while now. And Girard trying to apply some pressure. And I'm sure they're getting into a lot of that same lap traffic that the guys ahead of them in the XC1 Pro class have gotten into. So this may be interesting as far as this battle is concerned for the lead in XC2.
Here is your new leader, yeah. 969, and Jonathan Girard is out front, but in his shadow is the number one of Craig DeLong. Mikey Wayne pointed out earlier, we're almost getting to the point of a must win for Craig DeLong.
Yeah.
Johnny Girard, with the points that he has, with the number of wins that he's racked up, you know, he's kind of almost in a championship management mode. He doesn't need to win.
Right.
Craig DeLong absolutely must win to start chipping away at that points if he wants an opportunity to defend that number one plate.
That's it. And this is a good test for a young champion hopeful in Jonathan Girard to see if he can handle that pressure when it comes down to the wire like it is. And obviously, he can handle the riding end of it. He just goes out and rides his own races at this particular point. The way he looks at it is, if I don't let Craig win, I don't have to worry about
sure.
it.
Sure, yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I think if you look at the 2020 championship battle between these guys, Mike Wachowski very much in the thick of that one as well. And here is Mike Wachowski in the third place spot. So rounding out the podium right now in that XC2 class. You know, when we were here a year ago, it really was Johnny Girard who was in the championship driver's seat, not quite as firmly as he is now, but I believe he had the most wins and was kind of on a roll. Rui Barbosa, so Craig DeLong in second, third place was Mike Wachowski, and then Liam Draper fourth, and Rui Barbosa in fifth. So that's a good ride we've seen. We actually did see Rui on the podium once this year, but he's kind of seemingly to just get stronger each and
yes.
every race. But to that point of Johnny Girard, you know, he was in the driver's seat, so you got to wonder how much heavier is that leader's red plate this year, or green plate, than it was last year, knowing that he's almost got it locked up. He's just got to be smart these last couple of races.
Well, Stu Baylor still leads Jordan Ashburn, Ben Kelly, Josh Toth, and Thad Duvall as we are nearing the halfway point of today's racing action. And, of course, still a lot more to go. Can Stu Baylor hang on to it, or will we see a surprise here in Beckley? Stick around. GNCC Live continues after this.
Rocky Mountain ATV MC, retailer, distributor, manufacturer, product developer, parts tester. This is what we do. But who we are is something much simpler. We're riders like you. 100% employee owned and operated, a company built by riders entirely for riders. Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
Good morning. My name is John Coffey. I'm an AMS Oil dealer from Southern Virginia. Today's AMS Oil Spotlight, we're going to look at some of our two-cycle oils. Years ago, back in the day, it was kind of like a one-size-fit-all. But through technology and the changes in engines and things, we have actually developed specific oils for specialized situations. We have three of them on display right here. That this is HP High Performance Marine Oil, especially designed for outboard engines. That most of them are direct fuel injected engines now. Which that does is it makes them burn more efficiently. They'll get more power out of them, but it also makes them run leaner where there's less oil doing more work. So we have a special max dose advanced additive in those oils right there that helps prevent any kind of plug fouling and ring sticking. It keeps them super clean. It's a direct injection type of mixture, or if you're going to use a premix, it's a 50-1. Then we have our interceptor oil, specifically designed for snowmobiles. Those sleds are made to run wide open all day long. Those oils, this oil here has a heavy molecular structure to it that resists breakdown. It has a high flash point. The oils will actually pour out of the bottle at 63 degrees below zero. So you have super protection no matter how cold it is out there, out on the trails. There's low smoke. You're not gonna smoke out all your friends on the trail because it's going to be burning lean, and it you're just not going to generate as much smoke. Then we have the granddaddy of them all, our Dominator two-cycle oil. That there is specifically designed for high temperature, high RPM, extreme pressure type situations in all racing, whether it's outdoor boats, snowmobiles, motorcycles, ATVs. That's the top of the line as far as racing. It's got a high molecular structure to it as well. Highly resist breakdown. There's less friction, less drag. You're going to generate more horsepower and less heat. So that's just a little bit of information about our two-cycle oils. Thank you, and I hope you have a great day. And I just want to thank and appreciate all of the first responders and military that protect us and keep us safe. Thank you.
Human performance beyond biological limitation.
And welcome back to GNCC Live here at the Summit Bechtel Reserve, where we had the opportunity to be entertained by the Monster Energy Concert Series and big-time group from the late 90s and early 2000s, Lone Star, coming to the stage. Johnny, I tell you, that was an exciting show, man. It kind of took me back, and to hear all those songs, it was like I could have got up there and sung with them, I think, man.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, that's it's cool to see how much things have grown, and with having a partnership with Monster, the artists that they're bringing in, you know, these are not not that there's anything wrong with hometown heroes, you know, kind of trying to get their name out there, but these are world-renowned, you know, number one hit recording artists that are traveling to the GNCCs to put on a show for us, and what a show it was last night.
No doubt. Wrapped it up with fireworks last night. It's all a part of the Adventure on Freedom Fest and the Mountaineer GNCC in conjunction this week, as the West Virginia outdoor folks have really brought a lot and an extra edge, I think, here to the GNCC. Wow. Poor guys struggling out there, and again, that just goes to show the difficulty of what this course is, and if you don't make it on the first try, you certainly have got your work cut out for you, as you can see this rider. And it could mean something with the leaders coming this way also, because depending on where this guy is in his try back up the hill and what happens, it could play a factor in what's going on with these front runners.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, that's the thing in a lot of these sections. It only takes really one rider to kind of fall, and depending on which direction they fall, they can block 2-3 lines, and it just makes it a real challenge even for the top riders to be able to get through there, especially when you have a rider that kind of blocks up a good line, and then you have you know, some of the other back markers that end up plugging up some other lines. Here is Stu Baylor, so we'll see exactly what he does. He goes around the outside there, he's able to make pretty short work of it. Mm-hmm. Weaves his way right up through those ruts, and he's off.
Man, that was a smooth line he took around the outside too. It was kind of like on the outside of the rut, top side of the rut there. So good line choices there for Stu.
Yeah, and that really is the key. A lot of times when the track starts to get as ate up as it is right now, you got to get out of those deep ruts. You got to find where you can find some good dirt, find some traction, and that's exactly what Stu did through that section. And judging by the gap that he's opened up over Jordan Ashburn, mm-hmm. he might be doing that a lot of places.
Yeah.
Here is Ashburn now in that bright yellow helmet on the hammer, still, you know, within striking distance, but the gap seemingly to be opening up just little by little here as we start to get towards the middle of this three-hour affair.
Wow, Jordan Ashburn has really become one solid rider. Not that he has never been fast, but I mean just the solid rides and the consistency that he has shown this year. I mean, even great rides. I mean, he's riding the number three right now, Johnny. I mean, that should tell you a lot about his abilities. But even with that, I think that this year may be one of his more solid years. This could be the year that he's building on to be a threat for a championship in years to come.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, Jordan, he's been around a long time, but he's spent a lot of that time in the, you know, top three, top five in points. And as you pointed out earlier in the show, you know, a rider that we're all guilty of overlooking at times because doesn't rack up the big wins, doesn't ride the wheelies and, you know, slap the front number plate and a lot of the stuff that the other guys do when they're out front and winning. He just kind of is there always. He's super consistent. He's always in the mix for a top five or even a podium. And on days like today, you know, he's the best challenger Stu Baylor has. Ben Kelly there in the third place spot. We'll see exactly how that shakes out as far as what his gap is over his teammate and the confused number of Josh Toth, and it is tight. We had said it was 28 seconds, and then it got even tighter. And I think a rider to keep our eyes on is the 989 of Thad Duvall. I think we're going to see him put a push in and potentially try to close that gap up to Josh Toth and that number four spot. Not quite as close as maybe he was in the last camera shot. Seemed like he was a little bit closer, so you know maybe had a miscue there. We'll see exactly what the gap is, because they're coming to live timing here when they come through the finish line.
Right.
So we'll see the exact gaps based off their transponders. We should see that here probably in about the next 2 minutes.
So winding down another lap, working on lap number. Wow, is this number three we're on right now?
Number three. And there is Thad Duvall picking up on that nice inside line that his teammate Trevor Bollinger actually made earlier in the race. So Stu Baylor now through at the 9 mile marker. He is in the FMF PowerPoint, and you can see the fans cheering him on. A little dab there, and Stu is never afraid to be on the hammer, even if that Ampro Yamaha is not quite pointing the direction he needs it to be. He'll get it there eventually. He's a big old strong boy, and he pulls that 450 machine underneath him and just buries it.
Well, looking solid. The fans really liking Stu Baylor. I was noticing the fan support that he has. I think, no matter what state he is from and what state he goes to, he has got an amazing base of fans. But when we get down south, it really gets crazy how many Stu Baylor fans there are down there for sure. Here comes Jordan through. Race fan
offering him a cold Bud Light there just in case he wanted a refreshment. he took a pass, but you got to wonder if on the last lap that starts looking real good.
Anything cold, anything wet at that particular point possible.
And so Ashburn's still solidly in that second place spot. We wait now for the 5:30 of Ben Kelly in third and Josh Toth in fourth. Thad Duvall did come by there in fifth. We just before we cut to this PowerPoint section. So about a mile ago there at the 8 mile marker, Thad Duvall was still in that number five spot. Beyond that, we did not get to see those guys come through, but we think it may still be or actually Trevor Bollinger had made the pass and was up into sixth, and Lane Michael had dropped to seventh in that XC1 class. There is Ben Kelly charging down. That's a pretty gnarly, rocky downhill. You can't really see it on camera here, but you got to come into those rocks, make a left-hand turn, and then these rocks just keep getting looser. They're rolling around. And speaking with some riders from this morning race, it seemed like they had all pointed out that, man, the ground is just getting really rough and getting super choppy, hard on the hands, hard on the wrists, even hard on the knees. You're just trying to absorb all that. And there is Josh Toth.
As Josh Toth makes his way around, you know, I don't think it could go without mentioning what's going on in the point standings right here. In I know we put a lot of emphasis on the championship, but that number three, four, five, six plates, those are pretty important to a lot of riders right now. Jordan Ashburn sitting in the number three spot with 158 points coming into this race. Grant Baylor, who is out today, had 156. He was in the fourth place position, and with 153 points in fifth place, is Josh Strang. So Josh is having his issues today. So this is a good day as far as points go. He's finishing running second right now. If he can finish in that at least second place position, and if these guys, Grant not in, and Josh having his struggles, if he continues to struggle through the day, this could be monumental as far as Jordan in securing that number three plate for 2022. And you might ask, what is the issue that is going on with Grant Baylor?
I believe per what I had seen on social media, he was having a shoulder issue before the last National Enduro and elected to sit that race out, which, you know, definitely unfortunate because Grant has had a number of the shoulder issues in the last few years. You know, it's kind of a bit of a joke that the Baylor boys like to shoulder check trees when they're racing those Enduros. And I don't know that that is what causes any of these issues, but Grant has really been plagued by shoulder issues the last 3 or 4 years now. I can remember being in France for the ISD in 2017 even, and him speaking with his then KTM team manager about, you know, whether or not he should go ahead and get his shoulder fixed and how that might affect his, you know, potential for future rides going into the 2018 season. So again, yeah, 3-4 years ago, and he's kind of back there again. Now Jordan Ashburn there in the pits, fueling up there, getting some fuel in that Magna One Lubricants Husqvarna pit, and there see his wife Mary and the rest of the crew making sure he gets some water, some fresh goggles, some fuel, and he's on his way in pursuit of Stu Baylor and in the number two spot. And man, you know, just a super solid day so far for Jordan. You know, he'd like to find a way to make up that 15-20 seconds to get right there and be battling wheel to wheel with Stu, but still a lot of racing left.
Well, 36 and a half seconds is the gap now between Baylor and Ashburn as they check through at the end of three laps complete. We're still waiting, I believe, for Ben Kelly and Josh Toth and Thad Duvall to check in for the 3, 4, and 5 positions right now.
Well, we got a slight answer to our question about Stu Baylor. Just got a text from his mechanic. Corey McDonald actually just came through over an hour ago, and I'm just now seeing it. Ben Kelly on screen taking some fuel, some fresh Scott goggles, and some information being pumped his way. We see the pit board telling him what he needs to do, a little bit of motivational speaking going on, and Ben is out in search of hopefully trying to track down this man on screen right here, Stu Baylor. But to do that, first he's got to track down Jordan Ashburn, and that's going to be no easy task today.
No easy task for sure, but let me point out that, you know, this part of the race here is really where it seems that we see Ben Kelly come to life, and you know, all that training and all that extra work that he does off the bike to help him on the bike, this is where it really starts to pay the huge dividends. And this is where I believe in this last hour and a half that we got coming up, we're going to start to see things changing a little bit as far as that position between second and third. And if if Kelly rides like I think he's capable of and may do in this last hour and a half, if he can get around Jordan Ashburn, maybe even trying to whittle away some of that lead over Stu Baylor has over him right now. Another thing that he's got to do right now with only, 9-point deficit, I think, in the championship is if he can't take the win away from Stu, he's got to minimize the damage as much as possible. So that means he does need to get around Jordan Ashburn for the championship points race sake.
Well, yeah, I mean, you've got a great point there, Rodney. I mean, there's a 9-point gap between first and third. So right now, if things finish the way they're running, Stu Baylor and Ben Kelly leave here tied.
Yeah.
So the only way Ben Kelly can stop that from happening, you know, barring kind of just waiting and hoping that maybe Stu makes a mistake, is for him to go up there and at least starting getting some of those points back. And that starts by closing that gap to Jordan Ashburn and try to claw back those 4 points that he would earn, 4 additional points he would earn for second as opposed to third. But, you know, it's not going to be easy. I mean, Jordan Ashburn is riding incredibly well, and this is no small gap right now. You know, it's not like he's in sight. You can't see him. He's going off a pit board. So I think that might be kind of what that you could kind of see the sense of urgency on Antti Kaunonen, KTM team manager's face there, and everybody in his pits.
Like, well, nearly a minute, 57 and a half seconds is what he checked in behind Jordan Ashburn at the end of lap number three, a 29 minute and 15 second lap time for that rider. Josh Toth, by the way, checking in 24 seconds behind Ben Kelly. Thad Duvall is 37 seconds in fifth now behind Josh Toth. Looks like Jonathan Girard and Craig DeLong have checked in the battle for the lead in the XC2250 Pro Class. There's only 5 seconds separating those two riders right now, Johnny.
Yeah, a battle going on there in that XC2, and that is very much a championship battle as well. We talked about that. Oh, look at this. Unfortunate for Josh Toth. He's kind of the unfortunate position of just having a blocked up trail in front of him, losing just a few seconds. But Craig DeLong on screen on that number one Rockstar Husqvarna. Jameson Grinder is running the fuel jug there, and they are off and in pursuit. Don't know if he is ahead of Johnny Girard right now or if Johnny is ahead of him. I think you said there was a five-second gap.
Yep.
You know, with the fuel stops, that can change very rapidly. You know, if Johnny pitted this lap and had a slow stop, they could be wheel-to-wheel again here before you know it. Looks like Thad Duvall on screen, and as we pointed out, I think you said 35 seconds he was behind Josh Toth. So as the lappers get thicker, as these rock sections get more and more challenging, you know, 35 seconds becomes one stall, one fall, one bad line. So Thad Duvall trying to get up there. You know he wants to be, of course he wants to be winning, but you know he wants to be on that podium in his home state. But to do that, he needs to make up about 35 seconds on Josh Toth in front of him, and then about another 25 to Ben Kelly. So he's less than a minute, or right at a minute, out of a podium position, and seeming to kind of gain steam as we're going deeper into this one.
Yeah, deeper, and again, this last hour and a half, you know, this is where we saw the science and nutrition really change the face of how the racing is done in the last hour and a half, and generally how it finishes. But so many folks are on those same types of training regimens and on those same types of diets that the playing field is really starting to even out again. So you've got to be maybe that guy with the best edge on that diet plan or that training plan. And again, you know, I'm expecting to see Ben Kelly in this last hour and a half to maybe start to bridge a little bit of that gap, but there is a lot of gap there to bridge. But Jordan Ashburn just, again, never ceases to amaze me. And you know, he may be riding on the high of this solid second place ride, and he may be virtually untouchable by anyone behind him at this particular point.
So there is your sixth place rider on screen, sixth place overall, and sixth place in that. Oh, no longer sixth place overall, because look at this guy. This is your XC2 leader, points leader, and race leader, Johnny Girard, the 969 in that Coastal Racing Gas. And, you know, spent the last week or so with him in Italy. There is Lane Michael. You see his dad, Rick Michael, with the pit board saying, you're seventh place, get him back. Just in front of him is Trevor Bollinger, or just in front of Johnny Girard, actually. And there is Craig DeLong. So Craig not wanting to let Johnny Girard get away, but that was a little bit more than 5 seconds there. That was more like 15 or so. So he needs to definitely get up there and engage Johnny in a battle, because once Johnny gets out front, you know, that's a dangerous spot for Craig to allow him to be. Again, you just kind of get into that rhythm, you get into a flow, you're picking your own lines, you're doing your own thing, you're not worried about anybody behind you, and you know those gaps can just grow so easily once you get out front and you're just kind of feeling that flow. So Craig DeLong needs a win today, needs to challenge Johnny Girard. He's been doing a great job of it so far, but the gap is starting to open up just a little bit here on lap number 4.
Johnny, as this race wears on, it really starts to be, I think, very apparent how critical it is as far as, you know, what we've been talking about, points races, and the weight that these final four rounds carry, you know. And you can say it's always carried a lot of weight, but I have to think that this year there may be even more weight on some of these riders' shoulders than in previous seasons. It seems to me oftentimes when we get to this point, you know, we're starting to see that pecking order pretty much laid out before us, and it's becoming obvious of how it's going to finish. I don't think we're seeing that this year at all.
Yeah, I would agree with you. There is our third place rider in that XC2 Pro Lights class, Mike Witkowski. Solid ride for him so far. We've seen some struggles for him early in the season. We know he was kind of open about the fact that he had contracted the Epstein-Barr virus, and that was affecting his ability to train during the week and definitely affecting his energy levels on race weekends. Again, a very, very long race at 3 hours. We talk so much about training, but health is a huge thing. You know, if you're not at 100% health-wise, all the training in the world just isn't going to get you there. So Rui Barbosa now up to fourth on that number 14 Phoenix Racing Honda, and there is Liam Draper in the background, the 198 on that Tele Energy Racing KTM. So he is fifth. So third, fourth, fifth, all still pretty close there. Any one of those three guys definitely has a realistic shot at ending up on the podium. You know, if you're Mike Wiekowski, you want it to be you, you need to kind of reassert yourself in this class as a rider who was, you know, battling for wins earlier in the season to get back on the podium and be a big step in the right direction. Any one of those guys really kind of needing to be on the podium. But to your point about the pecking order kind of not seemingly to clearly establish itself this year, I think the one thing that we've talked about so much early in the season is the start to the season that Stu Baylor had. Obviously, sitting out round one, having a mechanical issue at round two, finishing 14th place, putting himself in such a big points hole that it would be hard to argue that the most dominant racer through 9, now halfway through this 10th round of racing, really has been Stu Baylor. But the man with the points lead all year long has been, well, just about all year long. Obviously, early in the season, Grant Baylor had the points lead after winning round one, actually carried that for a few rounds until Ben Kelly wrestled it away from him. And Ben Kelly has carried that since. But Ben Kelly has been fighting this championship battle, honestly, up until Snowshoe from his back foot. You know, he was constantly that second-place guy. Stu's grabbing the wins week in and week out.
Right.
And in a lot of cases, Ben Kelly was just really having to scrap late in the races to try and maximize his points to get to second or to even get to third in a lot of those races. So he's been the championship points leader with carrying that heavy red, you know, or reverse number plate. But the reality of it is he's kind of been more, I guess, defending than he has been offending. He's not been getting out there. He's not been sprinting away. He's not been winning the races. And that points lead just keeps getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So, you know, it's kind of an anomaly to say they're the guy that's carried the red plate or carried the leader's plate all season really hasn't been the dominant guy. You can't argue that it's been Stu Baylor from round three on. Stu Baylor's been the class of the field. So if you're Ben Kelly, you know, at Snowshoe, he made a big statement winning that race. And that was kind of, I was thinking that might give him the momentum, which we've still got over an hour of racing left here. But if you're Ben Kelly, you don't want to start off this four-race swing with the championship on the line going back to your back foot and defending that points lead, because even if he can get to second today, you know, as they finish now, they'd be tied. Even if he can get to second, he still would be giving up 5 points of that only 9-point lead he has. So, you know, you definitely need to get up there and challenge Stu. Keep Stu fighting from his back foot.
Right, exactly. And you know, you have to wonder which is the better place to be. I know to do that, you know, at the end of the season, that's probably the best way to approach that championship hunt, you know, laying back and being the defender instead of the offender. But, you know, now since he wasn't so much the offender, he has to be the offender, like you said, from this point on, I think, or things could turn around very, very quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and they to some point already have. You know, Ben had a very large points lead, at least on Stu, earlier in the year, and Stu has continued to chip away at that. Now with 4 rounds left remaining, or 3.5 or less rounds remaining, you know, Stu's in a position as they run to tie that points lead up today, and they would split that leader's reverse place going into round number 11. In Ohio in just 2 weeks. Now, that being said, and I don't think Stu is the type of guy that really lets things like this wear on him, but Stu has been in a nothing-to-lose situation almost all year. Now, if he's suddenly in the points lead or tied for the points lead, does that change his mindset? I don't think it does, but Stu Baylor has never, you know, we've seen him win Enduro titles, we've seen him win Sprint Enduro titles, we've seen him win XC2 titles, we've seen him now really get clicking off GNCC wins in terms of individual races, but he is not a rider we've ever seen battle for a GNCC overall title, ever. And think about that. Stu's been doing this a very long time. You know, Caleb Russell was just so dominant that, you know, I think probably the latest that Stu was even remotely involved in an overall title battle might have been round 3 or 4.
Right.
You know, so here we are now, round 10, going into round 11 here soon. And, you know, Stu is still very much in the thick of this, and hard to argue if he grabs this win today, possibly even in the driver's seat.
Right. Could be interesting to see what the remainder, or it is going to be interesting to see what the remainder of this season holds, let alone what the rest of this race day holds as we continue to roll through this now fourth lap of racing. This will put us right near that 2-hour mark when these riders check in, Johnny.
And we were talking earlier, and then we kind of got sidetracked. I got a text from Corey McDonald, Stu Baylor's mechanic, right, and said, hey, about what you guys saw on screen, I gave him a pit board saying, keep it smooth. He responded by starting to wipe off his number plate with the little crying face emoji is what Corey McDonald has to say about it. So he was basically sending, apparently, Corey McDonald a message saying, hey, I'm keeping it smooth. I'm out front. There's nobody in front of me. But I do think, you know, Stu Baylor watches motocross. There's no question about that. There's got to be something to what Griff and those guys are saying in the control room that apparently Jet Lawrence covering up that number eight and showing the number one winning that championship. You got to wonder what we won't know from Stu until the race is over.
Right.
But was his emphasis wiping off that number plate as he kind of like pointed at the number one, like, hey man, I got this. Right. You know, I'm in the number one spot. I'm going after the number one plate.
That's a pretty good point right there as well. So it'll be interesting to get the full details on that one. And
XC2 leader just came by, Johnny Girard. So we'll see what the gap is back to Craig DeLong.
A little larger than what I expected that it was going to be. I'm not going to lie to you. We've seen these guys a lot tighter than this all day long between these two. The most I've seen out of them, it seems like, until recently has been that 5-6 seconds that they've been riding against each other.
Yeah, he did just come by there on screen, so it looked to be, you know, maybe that 15-second range. Still very much within range if Craig's able to get some good lines, make some good passes on some lap riders. He could definitely be back up there battling for that lead here real soon.
Well, riders about halfway through this fourth lap of racing as we approach the two-hour mark here in the Mountaineer GNCC. Stu Baylor continues to control this one again. Ashburn in second, Ben Kelly, Josh Toth, and Thad Duvall. No changes in our top five. Stick around to see what happens here as we head for Checkers from Beckley.
This week in Yamaha history takes us back to September 24, 2005. It was the inaugural running of the Unadilla GNCC. And on a bright and sunny fall day in upstate New York, the then 8-time GNCC champion Bill Balance took to the early lead. The dry virgin course presented many challenges with rocks, roots, and the general terrain of the Unadilla Valley River for era greats like Bill Balance and his brother Brandon Balance, Santo Derisi, Andy Lagsons, Chris Jinks, William Yokley, Chad Duvall, and many, many more. As Balance had the lead early, he would run into some troubles, dropping to third place and then eventually to seventh place at the midway point of the race before driving all the way back to battle with the leaders at the end. In the meantime, North Carolina's Brian Cook and Missouri's Brian Baker battled with West Virginia's Chris Jinks for the lead. Jinks found some problems at the midway point himself, and he dropped back all the way to 11th. With two laps to go, Brian Cook took to the lead, holding on to the top spot down to the wire to finish 1:03 over Bill Balance and Brian Baker. And that's this week in Yamaha history.
Born of family values and a homegrown work ethic, Kometic Gaskets seals your machine so you can focus on the finish line. Kometic Gaskets are the competitive standard for racers who demand the very best. Kometic Gaskets are constructed from superior materials designed to perform in the most demanding environment. Whether it's championships on the line or a day in the dirt with friends, professionals and enthusiasts depend on Kometic. Kometic Gaskets, sealing championships since 1989.
AMSOIL runs on freedom and has since 1972. We changed the industry by formulating the first API-qualified 100% synthetic motor oil. The rest of the market has been trying to follow our lead ever since. But a head start is a head start. We punish our products firsthand in our world-class laboratories and beyond. Because some things can't be learned from a test tube. Run with us.
Thank you.
Last season was my best season ever by far. I won a lot of races. I won a championship, and it was also my first year using Arma. And one of the things I noticed was just my ability to string good days together. You know, like especially in the summertime in Florida, where you're riding every day and the heat index is 108 degrees and you're doing 230s and going to the gym and bicycle and all that stuff. I think in the past I've been super inconsistent day to day. Yeah, I may have a good race here or, you know, a good day during the week there, but overall I think where I improved the most was my consistency in my recovery.
Welcome back to GNCC Live from Beckley, West Virginia, the Summit Bechtel. As we are, of course, watching a little bit of highlights from last night's Stacey Grace. We saw Thad DeVall with his little boy there. But, of course, what we call EP, we brought to you by Stasic Stability Cycles. Man, droves of kids, families coming out, watching these kids ride. And these kids, man, they practice all day and all week just for these moments on Saturday night.
I don't know if they're so much practicing as they are just out there being kids. No, I agree with you, but man, like that's just it. Like right. You know, when you're young, you know, you might say like, "Oh, I'm going to practice," but man, they're just out there having the time of their lives riding these little Stasic bikes, and it's quite the happening at the GNCCs. I mean, the crowd comes out in droves. You know, obviously we got announcers, we got Ricky Ricky Towery with the flag. You know, and it's a great time for these kids and just gets them amped up about riding.
I've been watching a little girl since yesterday. She has worn the wheels off of her Stasic bicycle. She has just been going around. I don't know how long it takes to charge the batteries. Her mom and dad's got extra batteries, but she couldn't have been over 2.5 or 3 years old, and she has been on that thing all weekend long.
Yeah, I mean, Tracy Pickens, our multi-time ATV WXC champion, says that the Stasic is the best babysitter they ever got. You know, she could put JP on that, and he would just, you know, rip around the yard for hours and hours and hours on end. And I don't know how many between spending time with them and obviously Caleb and Chandler Russell at their place in North Carolina watching crew just wear those things out, replacing motors and wheels and tires. And it's like, man, you need a full-time Stasic mechanic. And that's not to say anything bad. I mean, they're phenomenal little machines, but nothing lasts forever.
No.
You know, they ride these things 6, 8, 10 hours a day. You know, stuff needs to be replaced.
Yes, I agree. And I got a grandson he's got a Strider bike. He's in line next for a Stasic, obviously. And already the only thing that he wants, I ask him what he wants for his birthday. He's getting ready to turn 2. What do you want? Green bike. He wants a Kawasaki. green bike. And I told Ryan Holiday that earlier today. I said, was telling he and Doug Duchette. And I said, boys, I said, you might have a prodigy on your hands. I said, he's got flaming red hair and he loves Kawasaki's.
There you go. That's been a good recipe for them in the past. So, yeah, it's wild to see the passion, the enthusiasm that the kids have to mm-hmm. just want to ride.
Yeah.
You know, at that age, it's... Of course, you know, we see that they want to win. They celebrate when they win a Stasic race or a micro race or a youth race. But it's just the passion for riding, I think, that excites me most.
I tell you, what Grayson likes to watch the most is hard enduro. All he wants to watch on is grab an iPad or either on your TV, YouTube. He wants to watch hard enduro. I mean, he loves that challenge.
this little section of hard enduro right here, Stu Baylor making it look like it's nothing but a highway, but we know we've watched lap riders and other riders struggle through that section with the exposed roots, the loose rocks, carrying the moisture up. Look at this. Mm. I believe that Jordan Ashburn has closed that gap up even more. We've seen it as high as 20-some seconds. We've 36 seconds we've seen it up to. But that was no 36 seconds. That wasn't 26 seconds. Rodney, that wasn't even 16 seconds. That was about 12 seconds, give or take. We'll see exactly what the live timing and scoring says here when they check in just about another 2 miles of action. And the next rider we are waiting and watching for is the 530, that Red Bull Factory KTM of Ben Kelly.
I tell you, this will be a good tell as to whether or not Jordan Ashburn is closing the gap up from behind or whether Stu is starting to slow down some. If this gap has really opened up more over the 530, then that could be the telltale sign there, I think.
Yeah, it's we see one of our 150B riders, Matthew Hollenbeck, on the 327 machine coming through. Rider, I always try to keep an eye on. Those little 125, 150 machines are ppretty fun to listen to out there. As Mikey Wayne's like to say, the sound of our people with that FMFX C3 class. Everybody loves to hear those two strokes get wound out. Rodney, I think we have an answer. I don't believe that Stu Baylor lost time. I think Jordan Ashburn put in a charge and has closed up that gap on Stu Baylor, because the gap back to Ben Kelly in third has definitely gotten even larger, I think. And there we see Ben. Oh, it's gotten quite a bit larger because he's got now some pressure from behind with his teammate of Josh Toth there. And that battle right there is over the final podium spot. And now that brings into question the point swing of 9 points back to third. Could even turn to be, I believe it would be 12 points back to fourth.
And how much of a kicker would that be to have your teammate get around you at that particular point? And, you know, we know they're out there racing individually, but they've got the same sponsors out there going on right now. So, you know, that has to probably play in the back of the mind of Josh just a little bit. Do I pass him and help him win this championship, or do I not pass him and help him win this championship, or do I pass him and do what's best for me and what's right for me at this particular point? And so I'm sure he's weighing a few questions as he closes in on the rear fender of the 530 at this particular point.
Yeah, I don't know that those kind of things are as a rider in Josh's shoes. I mean, I'm sure he's aware of the point situation, but, you know, there's 4 rounds of racing left. And he's trying to get himself on the podium. You know, I think he's just going to, if he has the opportunity, I'm sure they'll race each other clean as they would. They're good friends and always have been. But I'd be pretty confident that if Josh Toth has the opportunity to make a pass, he's going for it. Another rider, perhaps, with an opportunity to make a pass, might be that guy right there, the number three on that Magna 1 Lubricants, Husqvarna. He is pushing and pushing very, very hard up to the rear fender, nearly, of the 514 Ampro Yamaha, Stu Baylor.
Wow, so going to be an interesting one as we close in on the final hour of racing here in Beckley and the kickoff to the final leg of the 2021 season. Man, 4 more rounds left to go, or this one, 3 more after this one, as we were saying. We'll be heading to Ohio at Burr Oak in a couple weeks, back to the home of the John Penton in Millfield, Ohio. We'll be going back to the Buckwheat 100. I really liked that place last year. It was kind of small and quaint, and was big and quaint at the same time. And, of course, Ironman will wrap it all up here in the 2021 GNCC Championship season. But a lot of challenges still lie ahead as we continue to lay here in wait to see what this rest of this field is starting to shape up like now.
Yep, we're waiting, and we'll see. Has Josh Toth been able to make his way around his teammate, the number 530 of Ben Kelly? Has Thad Duvall been able to close that gap up at all? Here is Ben Kelly still in the number 3 spot and still with a shadow behind him of his teammate, Josh Toth there. So still 3 and 4 right together. 1 and 2 are bunched up. 3 and 4 are bunched up. So we got 4 riders realistically fighting it out over only 3 podium positions. As they run, one of these guys is going to be left out in the cold here in about another little over 2 laps of racing.
Well, there you have it. You see it. He has him in his sights. It's not wheel to wheel just yet, but there's only a handful of seconds, maybe 4 seconds or three, that separate those two riders as they make their way around this race course, heading for the finish line. With a couple laps left to go. Here comes Stu Baylor. I think we'll probably get the two lap board out if I'm calculating this right in my mind, Johnny.
Yeah.
We'll see as he snakes his way through the woods and then into the chicanes here right now. And Ricky Towery, our finish line flagger, in hand, that two lap board as expected. So two more to go. That basically means about an hour when these riders are turning at 28, 29 minute lap time. Stu Baylor on lap three turned a 28:27. Once we get updates here on the timing and scoring, we'll be able to update that for you here in just a few moments on what that lap time was. But the gap, again, you know, we're looking at a 36-second gap that was a 36-and-a-half-second gap that was between first and second. That's the impressive thing there, is that gap nearly bridged between Stu Baylor and Jordan Ashburn now, as we see the Magna One Motorsports team cheering him on as he heads down through pit row with Stu Baylor in sight.
Excitement for those guys. This is the first opportunity they've really had kind of late in a race to grab a win. You know, within sight of Stu. There you see Stu, the rider, first rider on screen, the third rider back there in that bright yellow helmet is Jordan Ashburn. So 36 seconds, no more, not even maybe less than 6 seconds. So he's definitely put in a heater that lap. Stu Baylor not really off the pace with a 28 some odd. Well, actually, I'm sorry, that was lap three. We were waiting for the live timing and scoring to reload for lap four, but and here we see Ben Kelly now taking a look over his shoulder. And that was the one thing I noted. Stu really took a long, long, long look over his shoulder multiple times, almost as if to say, really? Like, Jordan's still there? Like,
right.
I haven't shaken this guy yet. Like, it's pretty late. I want to be done with this. I want this battle to be over. But not able to shake him thus far. That was a pretty interesting exchange right there. Don't know if you caught that, Rodney, but the number 206-207 machine of Josh Toth actually taking a water bottle handoff from Ben Kelly's mom. So,
wow.
You know, those guys, good friends. I've traveled together for a long time, and I believe that's who it was. I could be mistaken, but it sure looked to be Ben's mom who actually made the water bottle handoff.
Mom, what are you doing?
Hey, you know, that those teams, those guys, they help each other out. You know, they're racing each other bitterly on the track. But, you know, you got to keep all those guys hydrated.
No doubt about it. Got to keep everybody healthy and safe on the racetrack. As Kelly winds his way through the pro pits now, again, waiting on the overall update on what that official time is between first and second. I know 36 and a half seconds. We had 57 and a half. And at one point looking, I think, well over a minute between the second and third place position, and a 24-second gap that Josh Toth had bridged up to the 530 of Ben Kelly there. Man, what a rock garden.
There is Stu. Looking like he's starting to open things up maybe just a little bit again over Jordan Ashburn. So maybe those long looks over his shoulder inspired a little sense of urgency in him to say, you know, hey, all right, you've hung back there long enough. I think I'd like to go ahead and open this back up.
Yeah, it's up to about 10 seconds now. We just counted out there. So a 10-second gap opened up very quickly between first and second place. And with the two lap boards shining, you know, I have to wonder for these guys. It seems like, you know, we see that kind of mid-race lull at about halfway, you know, at the hour and a half mark or leading into that. I like to say usually around the 115 to 145 mark is when you see that halfway lull between the riders. And then at about the 145 to 2 hour mark, right in that 2 hour mark, they start to peak with their speed starting to pick back up. And that may be where we're headed into now with the two lap board coming out. I have to think that might be the signal for these guys that it's go time again.
Yeah, I think the signal for Stu Baylor was seeing that bright yellow helmet in his rear view.
Right.
You know, when he turned around, took that nice long look and said, really, man? You know, I was really hoping to cruise this one in the last two laps, and you're not going to let me do that, are you, Jordan? The sign for Jordan to go now is seeing that Stu's definitely, at least visibly looking on the racetrack and kind of seeing the way he's riding. Stu is really putting in a sprint lap. You know, if you're in the situation where Stu Baylor is Ben Kelly on screen, third place, he's also got a water bottle hanging there. So maybe Dawn, Ben's mom, was able to get him a water bottle as well as his friend and teammate behind him there of Josh Toth. So she got to make sure to take care of both of her boys.
There you go.
And I believe the next rider by will be, here he is, the number 206 of Josh Toth.
So Toth by now, and just about a 5 second gap or so, 6 seconds back to between he and Ben Kelly as he continues to push. The one rider that, Thad Duvall should be checking in now. He was 37 and a half seconds at the end of lap number three behind there, Johnny. So it'd be interesting to see what's gone on with the 989 in that fifth place position.
That's him right there, the last rider coming up through the trees. He is West Virginia's own. He surely knows how to ride the rocks. Doesn't look like he's made any inroads into that gap to the fourth place rider of Josh Toth or the third place rider of Ben Kelly, but still definitely within striking distance. Should either of those guys either lose the pace a little bit or even have a mistake?
You know, I look at it, you know, I know a lot of people say, hey, what's going on with Thad? And we know that he's had a lot of injury. But, you know, I think that this season, even though we haven't seen, the comeback rides and the flashes of brilliance that and amazingness that we are used to seeing from Thad Duvall, I think that this has been a very mature healing process for him, I think. I think, obviously, at the beginning of the year, he had to wash away the hopes of winning the championship. So instead of coming out here and trying to set the world on fire and keep his name as a part of it, he I think he's focusing on it a little bit more differently and approaching it in a little more methodical process. What we're seeing here may not be reflective of what we're going to see out of Thad Duvall when we hit round one in February of 2022.
Yeah, anything's possible. I think there's a lot of questions about I think coming into this year, Thad was on the very short list of people who were favorites to win this title with Caleb stepping away from racing. He was obviously probably, he and Josh Strang were the two riders that really did the most battling with Caleb over the years. And Thad arguably probably was able to wrestle the most wins away from Caleb, individual race wins. It seemed with the struggles he had earlier this year, like you said, it's been kind of a building process throughout the year, and we'll see where he ends up next year. I don't know if he's back with that Rockstar Husqvarna team. That team really struggled this year with injuries between Thad and Trevor Bollinger. So will they, you got to believe they're going to give Thad another crack to come back and continue to try to win races and battle for a championship.
I would think that they're probably going to. I mean, I can't see them going in any other directions right now because, Thad's already familiar with the program. They're familiar with him as Johnny Girard makes his way by there now.
And
was that him?
It was. Absolutely. Your XC2 leader, Johnny Girard, the 969. There is the 739, the other Rockstar Husqvarna of Trevor Bollinger. And solidly in a sixth place spot, Thad Duvall in fifth. So in five and six, talking about that team that's been riddled by injury and many times didn't even have an XC1 rider on the course, just relying on Craig DeLong as they did, honestly, almost all of last season.
Yeah.
So it's to see two guys in the top six, that's a big step in the right direction for them and their sponsors.
Yeah, it is, and I can't wait. Again, I can't wait to see what the 2021 or 2022 championship brings because so many riders will be coming back healthy and with a fresh and clean slate. I think can use this year as a good learning tool. Like you said, there were so many folks that were hopeful being able to capitalize and take advantage of the fact that Caleb Russell wasn't here any longer as Craig DeLong makes his way by, still second in the XC2 250 Pro class, and it looks like that gap is opening up between first and second in that class too, Johnny.
Yeah, we saw 5 seconds, we saw 15, and I think now we've made our way upwards of 30 seconds. So Johnny Girard really starting to open up that gap and kind of assert himself as not only the championship points leader, the rider with the most wins, but seeming to be a rider that is looking to try to kind of put this championship out of reach for the other riders. Lyndon Snodgrass in the background there, stuck between two trees, going the opposite direction. He would actually be over at the 9-mile marker, so a challenging day. Looked like he was almost making an adjustment to the bike there when he stopped. Challenging day for Lyndon, a rider we've seen battle for podiums and finish on the podium a number of times here earlier in 2021. We got a number 316 machine. I would say that's Chuck LeMaster, but I know Chuck raced this morning. So another 316 out there in the afternoon. We're waiting on the leaders here at the 4-mile marker. We'll see. Has Jordan Ashburn been able to actually physically attach himself to Stu Baylor? You know, that gap just it seemed to be down to the point where Jordan just needed that one final pull, one final push, one final, you know, oomph to get right to the rear wheel of Stu Baylor. And if he can do that, man, then you kind of almost get that that virtual draft. Yes, there's no drafting in dirt bike racing. We've talked about this, but it's that the mental draft.
Right.
You almost can shut your brain off, just hit their lines, do what they're doing. Or if Jordan really wants to shake things up a bit, he might just start taking shots at Stu right away. When I say taking shots, you know, trying to make those passes, taking those inside lines, trying to sweep around the outside, just trying to keep the pressure on this man right here, Stu Baylor. So has the sprint that Stu put in resulted in opening up the gap at all? Looks like it has.
There's 10 seconds right there.
So 15. All that work that Jordan did to get it back down to, I think we had it at under 7 seconds, has now grown back
20.
To, we're over 20 seconds and still no Jordan Ashburn. So the gap that he had worked so hard to make up, Stu Baylor took a long look over his shoulder, saw this man right here in the bright yellow helmet, was able to open that gap back up. But I will point out, earlier in the race, we were noticing it seemed that this was the section of track where Stu Baylor was strongest,
right.
And Jordan seems to be stronger later in the lap, just before they come back to VP Fuels Pro Row and to the finish line scoring chicane. So will he be able to kind of inch things back up closer? I don't know. Obviously,
27 second difference from an 8.2 second difference when they came through the finish line to mile marker number 4. So you're right about that in Stu Baylor and Jordan Ashburn. Mikey Wayne standing by down in the pits. He's got some big news, sounds like.
Hey guys, just want to give you a little strategy update out of the XC2 class. Last lap around, Rockstar Husqvarna rider Craig DeLong took a pit stop. Johnny Girard did not take a pit stop. He did this lap. So Johnny Girard getting some fuel in that that difference there with those guys doing opposite pit strategy. Johnny Girard, as you guys know, is able to work his way in front of Craig DeLong as DeLong was taking a pit. Johnny Girard came in this last time, got some fuel, and he's still out ahead of Craig DeLong. So that strategy here at the factory gas pits paying off for him right now. Take it back to you guys.
All right, thanks for that update. And I'll tell you, looking at the difference there at the end of lap number 4, between Craig DeLong and Jonathan Girard, when we were looking at 5 seconds, 6 seconds, and so forth in the early part of this race, 1 minute, 22 seconds now, Johnny.
Yeah, you know, that's that. You want to talk about playing strategy. Johnny Girard was able to get that lead by not taking the pit. Here is Ben Kelly. Now your third place rider is through, and he does still have the shadow of his teammate there, the 206 of Josh Toth. We know it's give or take about 35, 40 seconds back to Thad Duvall in that number 5 spot. But Josh Toth not going to make it easy on Ben Kelly just to go ahead and collect his podium, get his points, and get out of here with a wash. Not a wash, but get out of here tied
right.
For the points lead with Stu Baylor, assuming Stu hangs on to the lead here. So Josh Toth, really the man that kind of has got all the cards to play. You
right.
know, if he can make a move, if he can wrestle that third place spot away, gets to celebrate, you know, his sponsors and himself on the podium, bumping his teammate off. But I'm sure Ben Kelly not wanting to hand over that podium position without a fight.
No, not at all. On so many different levels, obviously championship being probably the biggest one of those, but you don't want to let these guys beat you, especially this late in the season, to give them that confidence. With Stu Baylor out front by now some 30 seconds over Jordan Ashburn, Ben Kelly a minute and 37 seconds back in third, and right behind him 6 seconds back in fourth is Josh Toth. Thad Duvall still holding on to a top five now
42 seconds back. So what a great run we've got. Still a little more time to go and still time for things to change as we continue here in our closing moments of this Rocky Mountain ATV MC Mountaineer GNCC. Stick around. GNCC Live continues with more from Beckley, West Virginia after this on GNCC Live.
Rocky Mountain ATV MC, retailer, distributor, manufacturer, product developer, parts tester. This is what we do. But who we are is something much simpler. We're riders, like you. 100% employee owned and operated, a company built by riders, entirely for riders. Rocky Mountain ATV MC, get ready.
The directive: advance human performance beyond biological limitation.
Born of family values and a homegrown work ethic, Kometic Gaskets seals your machine so you can focus on the finish line. Kometic Gaskets are the competitive standard for racers who demand the very best. Kometic Gaskets are constructed from superior materials designed to perform in the most demanding environment, whether it's championships on the line or a day in the dirt with friends. Professionals and enthusiasts depend on Kometic. Kometic Gaskets, sealing championships since 1989.
AMSOIL runs on freedom and has since 1972. We changed the industry by formulating the first API-qualified 100% synthetic motor oil. The rest of the market has been trying to follow our lead ever since. But a head start is a head start. We punish our products firsthand in our world-class laboratories and beyond. Because some things can't be learned from a test tube. Run with us.
Last season was my best season ever by far. I won a lot of races. I won the championship, and it was also my first year using Arma. And one of the things I noticed was just my ability to string good days together. You know, like especially in the summertime in Florida, where you're riding every day and the heat index is 108 degrees and you're doing 230s and going to the gym and bicycle and all that stuff. I think in the past I've been super inconsistent day to day. Yeah, I may have a good race here or, you know, a good day during the week there, but overall I think where I improved the most was my consistency in my recovery.
Even when you're the best, you never stop striving to be better. With over 40 years of experience in motorcycle sales and service, we know racing. Our inventory of Yamaha motorcycles, sport bikes, dirt bikes, ATVs, and side-by-sides is extensive and constantly changing. Stop by LoJack Cycle Sales today in Tarentum, Pennsylvania, and visit our online inventory at www.lojacks.com. Yamaha YZs, it's why we ride.
Hi, my name is Andrea Lee, the director of On Track School. How would you like to go to a school where we take into consideration how students learn best? Well, we do that because we find if we can build the curriculum around the things you are interested in, you're going to do a better job. The mission at On Track School is that educational success is possible while chasing your dreams. Not only will our staff help students to achieve success, they will cheer you on to the finish line. We encourage you to check out On Track School at ontrackschool.com, where we can help you chase your dreams and still get a quality education.
We are American motorcyclists. We are members of the American Motorcyclist Association. Racers, fans, and crew, we come together for this sport we love, to race together, to grow together.
Welcome back to GNCC Live on RacerTV.com. Rodney Tomlin along with Johnny Gallagher and our man out in the pits today, Mr. Mikey Waynes, as we wait on the leaders here at the 8-mile marker. Two-lap board coming out there just a little bit ago. And now as these riders traverse this section of the race course, they will be heading toward the white flag. And one more lap to go coming into this lap. We saw that Stu Baylor had saw that gap shrink from 30-plus seconds, 36 and a half seconds, down to 8.2 seconds, and even physically closer than that on the racetrack at times. But we've seen it now open back up, Johnny, at about midway through this lap, up to nearly 30 seconds. What will we bear witness to when these riders come in here at mile marker number 8? Will we see the gap larger? This seems to be the area of racetrack, maybe where Jordan Ashburn might be a little bit faster.
Yeah, he's been a little bit faster, I think, in this section, but not 30 seconds. You know, it's I think he's been able to chip away maybe 6, 8, 10 seconds in this section of racetrack in previous laps. But as you pointed out, when we were looking at lap times there as we kind of stepped away, Stu with a 29.32 that previous lap on lap number 4, that's where that time came from. You know, he was nearly a minute off of his previous lap time of a 28.37. So 55 seconds slower he was that lap. You know, don't know if that was a function of, Stu Baylor on screen with four-stroke A lights or 250A rider, Lane Whitmer in front of him, rider that wrapped up that B-class championship at our last round at Snowshoe, and now is up there in the A-class, and he's got some heat behind him right now from the big man, Stu Baylor, on the 514 Ampro Yamaha. We do know, like you said, around 30, 37 seconds is what it was back to Jordan Ashburn. I don't think that we're going to see him have made up a significant amount of time in this section of racetrack, obviously. I think Stu now knows he's there. He got caught off guard maybe a little bit, had a bad lap, maybe fell into a false sense of security, thought he could kind of cruise it home. And with the sprint that he put in the first 8 miles of lap number 5, he's opened up a considerable gap over Jordan Ashburn once again.
Well, 35 seconds we've already calculated, so we'll be coming at right at the 40-second mark now that we're seeing the gap opened up to between first and second. And Jordan really seems to still be on the push right now.
Yeah, I think he is. And again, looking at those lap times, it was kind of deceiving because Stu had put in a 28.37 the previous lap. So Jordan on the lap we thought maybe was a burner was a 29.04. So that still would have been roughly 21 seconds off of what Stu had done the lap before that. So it really was more a facet of Stu kind of giving up that time rather than Jordan gaining it. But, you know, still, when they come in now, it'll be a white flag waving. So this thing is far from over. They still have 10 miles.
Yeah.
A very, very, very treacherous racetrack with lots of rocks and creeks and roots and all kinds of stuff that can jump up and bite you. So one thing I did notice, Rodney, there when you were doing kind of – you were scrolling through the timing, live timing and scoring there, it looked like down towards the 17, 18 – 19 area, we had some top amateur riders that were actually maybe a bit of a surprise. JoJo Cunningham has been a top amateur a number of times this year, but it's actually Dakota DeVore in the 19th place spot who is our top amateur leading that 250A class with a minute and 15 second gap over JoJo Cunningham.
Yeah, pretty impressive and good to see new names rising to the occasion like that. JoJo needs that kind of battling right now. As you know, he is looking to make his way up through the ranks and eventually to this front row in the XC1 Pro class.
Here is our third and fourth place riders. Can't talk about one without the other. They've been glued to each other about the last almost full lap of racing now here as if they're at the 8 mile marker. Well, it's actually been exactly a lap since we saw them really kind of tighten up and they've been right together. In another 2 miles, they're going to see a white flag waving, and that's going to mean just one more revolution around this Mountaineer Summit Bechtel facility for them to kind of sort out that final podium position. You know, we'll see who's able to come out on top of that one and get that, not only the podium position, but the points. If you're Ben Kelly, those points are far more important than just the podium itself.
Back to the top amateur, Johnny, just to let you know, Bubs Tasha has the 22nd place position overall. He's third in the 250A class, and he's also third overall top amateur. So right now, all three top amateurs would be coming from the 250A class.
And actually, looking at that, he's only 34 seconds behind JoJo Cunningham, so about a minute 45 separating the top three in that class and top three overall amateur. And again, as we pointed out, this track is tough. Minute 45 is that can disappear pretty quickly.
Most certainly can, and right now waiting at the 9 mile marker, about a mile or so just before the finish line itself, where again we're anticipating a white flag to be waving for Stu Baylor whenever he checks in, and or if someone else makes the pass and comes in the lead. But our time, I mean, we're getting there. 2.5 hours nearly into this race right now, and we'll be right probably 10 minutes shy of a 3 hour race completed whenever the leaders check in.
There you go. So Jordan Ashburn now through at the 9 mile marker there at the FMF PowerPoint. In second place solidly, still good little gap over Ben Kelly and his teammate Josh Toth. They're in the third and fourth place. Those are the riders we should be seeing next here as they enter in through the Monster Mile and then head towards that FMF PowerPoint. So our kind of spectator sections are kind of back to back. We've got the Monster Energy Mile and the FMF PowerPoint are just right together here at the 9 mile marker. Just a gnarly section of course they're able to traverse through multiple times, and actually that rock garden going the other direction, the split line rock garden that we have a shot of there at the 1 mile marker, is just across that white string the other direction. So one of the more picturesque areas where you can kind of take it all in, see some battling on the way out and on the way back.
Johnny, did you ever find yourself in yesterday's race being just taken by the beauty and the views that may have been afforded you out there during the race?
Yeah, I don't really know what I was doing out there yesterday. So Ben Kelly looking like he's opened it up just a tiny little bit over Josh Toth. Josh isn't glued right to his rear fender, but I don't exactly know if we've how much we've seen that open up, but he's not in the same camera shot, so that's a little breath of fresh air if you're Ben Kelly. But if you're Josh Toth, if you want to get on that podium, you can't let that guy get out of your sight.
There's Stu Baylor taking the white flag. One more lap to go now here at the Mountaineer GNCC, the one that began the terror that Stu Baylor has placed upon the GNCC since a year ago. Happy anniversary, Stu Baylor, going to try to cap this one off with a big win. And remember, just think back to 1 year ago, where we were in this championship, or just not necessarily in the championship, but just in the grand scheme of of what's taking place this year. He actually set the stage for what we got going on here when Stu got that week by week.
All right, that was definitely not a coincidence. He's sending a message there, wiping off that. And you notice, I think I'm going to go with the guys in the booth here. He was not wiping the whole number plate, just that number one in the middle.
But man. This is just great. Like I said, a year later, race by race, deal with the M-Pro Yamaha. If he did okay, they might let him race it again the next week. And they did okay. And he just came out 1-1-1-1. I mean, it's crazy what has taken place in Stu Baylor's racing career since 1 year ago.
Yeah, it's been a wild ride for sure. You know, he was on, I think, three different brands after the famous, very public split with his former employer at Sherco. Obviously, all during the COVID times, we were away from racing for 8 weeks. We came back to Stu Baylor with the machine with the me on the graphics and said, hey, I'm done with those guys. They're done with me. We want to go racing, but I got some infection and some knee issues. And then it was from there. Honestly, that lasted all the way until the summer break of no racing for Stu Baylor. And, you know, a lot of people in the industry question, you know, would he come back? And if he came back, you know, what would that mean? You know, where would he be? Where would he stack up in the rankings? And when he came out, he came out swinging at this race, like you said, 1 year ago on the Sampro Yamaha, started winning right away and really, minus a few hiccups, kind of hasn't stopped. It's just been a lot of winning. And what does Ricky Bobby say in that movie? I'm just a big, hairy American winning machine. Stu Baylor, you pointed out, isn't exactly clean shaven this weekend, but maybe he's going for that just big, hairy American winning machine. he's certainly showing that he's capable of it here today, no question.
That is for sure, as he continues to hold the point here. 1 minute, 1.9, so 102, 1 minute and 2 seconds back to Jordan Ashburn. Now, Ben Kelly, 1 minute and 9 seconds back in the number three spot. Josh Toth about 12 seconds off the pace when they checked in there at the finish line behind Ben Kelly. So he's gained that ground and bridged that gap and has gotten no farther than the rear fender of Ben Kelly as Stu Baylor makes his way through this monster section of the race course. And you can see it too is becoming quite a bit of a challenge as Stu made his way through. Not going to say it's been smooth at all at any time, but new rocks kicking up there and this part of the course changing throughout, I think, the course of this race day.
Like we talked about a little bit earlier in the show, Rodney, the rocks here are a little bit different than they are at somewhere like Snowshoe, or honestly even at Masontown, Marvin's Mountaintop, where we raced for so many years. This place, the rocks are kind of mobile. They move themselves around, you know, just a spinning wheel, even just kind of glancing off them sideways with the tire will kind of push them just a little bit. They're not the big stuck in the ground kind of rocks as a whole. They're kind of just these rocks that shift around, and it's a very ever-changing track surface that we have here this weekend. And so far today here on Sunday, the man who's adapted to it best has been Stu Baylor. But shout out to this man, Jordan Ashburn. You know, Rodney, we've talked about it. We have a tendency to overlook him. But with that bright yellow helmet and his riding today, he has made it very difficult to not pay attention to Jordan Ashburn and that Magna One Lubricants Husqvarna today. He's been up front in the thick of the battle all day long.
I wonder if he chose that bright yellow helmet to say, hey, guys, look at me. Here I am. So you can't miss me now.
He's been wearing that actual helmet all year this year. Yeah. I don't know if it's that specific one, but that paint scheme has been his helmet throughout the entirety of 2021. And maybe that's part of it. You know, Jordan's a guy that isn't very flashy with his riding when he's on the racetrack, so maybe he's going to let that helmet do the talking for him and say, Johnny, Rodney, Mikey, all you guys, I'm tired of you overlooking me. I'm tired of you just thinking, you know, I'm just out here to have fun. He said, you know, he's here to win races. So,
yeah.
And that helmet is making that statement for him. Ben Kelly, a rider that, you know, has had a good solid day. He's been in a podium position throughout the day. But, you know, if you're a Ben Kelly fan, if you're a KTM fan, if you want to see that number one plate on that FMF KTM Red Bull machine at the end of the year, this isn't necessarily the way to have gotten it done today. Not a disastrous day, but, you know, giving up as it runs now 9 points in the championship definitely puts him in a position where he's now got a battle kind of on an even playing field with Stu Baylor. He no longer has that points lead, Pat.
So that would mean I guess in a way we could be looking at the possibility of a leader plate split. So two riders were riding the leader plates.
If it finishes the way it is right now, it would be exactly that. It would be both of those riders having the right to run the reverse plates. Of your series points leader, Ben Kelly, and Stu Baylor would be tied in the points if they finish the way they run that right now, with Stu Baylor in the number one spot and Ben Kelly in the number three spot. But Josh Toth potentially looking to play spoiler in that. Still, as you said, only about 12 seconds back from Ben Kelly. And Josh, as a rider that you know, has been working hard to try and get that podium. And again, he's already had one this year, but he surely would like to have another here this weekend.
So continuing to wait and watch to see how this race is going to unfold. We are under white flag conditions. Obviously, five laps now complete with 28-29-minute lap times. Okay, here's something. 28-21 that last time around for Stu Baylor. So
that 28-37 that seemed so blistering a couple laps ago, suddenly he was just cruising on that one. That 28-21. I'm telling you, Rodney, it was that look over the shoulder. You know, I think obviously as a rider, he probably knew he either had some miscues or lost some pace or whatever it may be. So I'm sure he wasn't entirely shocked that it wasn't his greatest lap of the race. But I think when he looked over his shoulder and saw just how close Jordan Ashburn had gotten, that's when Stu Baylor kicked it into all business mode and said, all right, let's get this done. Let's put in a sprint lap. And yeah, I don't know that we'll see the same pace out of him this lap. It may be a situation where he's just kind of managing that 1 minute gap that he has, but Stu's a wild card. You just never know. He could go out there and put in a 27 minute lap on this last one just to really flex on these guys and kind of get in their heads.
Yeah, that would probably do it in these conditions to be able to have your fastest lap, the very last lap and do it convincing like that. Yeah. Stu, you know, that's one thing that, you know, not only does he try to do on the racetrack, beat them on the racetrack, but he tries to beat them during the week as well. I think a lot of those mind games and calling it joking around, calling it whatever you will sometimes. So I think he really, you know, whatever it is that he does, he really gets a lot of people's attention. Some guys, you know, love it and they revel in it and they go with it themselves. Other guys, probably a little shaken by it, you know. Is that a shot at me? Did he mean that towards me? What's that all about?
Yeah, and I think sometimes the mind games can be just exactly that. Sometimes they're just mind games. Guys say things, do things, just to try and get a razz out of their competition. And, you know, Stu is a rider that I think, you know, I think he's definitely been involved in the mind games in the past and things he said in interviews or other guys have said about him in interviews. You know, I think if we go back a few years, it was kind of almost comical, the jawing that he and Caleb Russell would do back and forth with each other. You know, friends off the track, they could go, you know, go fishing or go golfing or whatever. But when it came to their track interviews, you know, Stu would essentially kind of take shots at Caleb to try to rock Caleb off of his foundation. Caleb would you know, never really hold his tongue, and he would lip right back at Stu. And but in this case, I think you know, Stu's doing so much talking on the track with his results, he almost doesn't even really need to play those mind games. No. I don't think, but I think he still enjoys it. it keeps it fun for him, you know. And I don't know. I think the wiping of the number plate or the accentuation of the number one, I don't know that that's so much even aimed at his competitors. No. As maybe it is kind of a flex to Corey McDonald, his mechanic. You know, Corey's telling him, hey, man, just keep it smooth. And maybe that's Stu's way of basically telling Corey, like, hey, bud, I got this. Like, you do you. You make sure I got gas and goggles. I'm going to handle the riding part of this.
Yeah, and you know, you bring up a point when you say Corey McDonald. What a story that is. A backstory is a part of this championship run that Stu Baylor has going this year. You know, I mean, these two competitors and always been great friends, but competitors as youth riders and through the amateur ranks and so forth, to be able to come together at this point in the career, Corey being the elite leader of, you know, the Ampro Yamaha mechanical side of things, and Stu being the elite rider that he is, to be able to come together and join together and experience it together the way that they are. Because, you know, when the rider wins, the mechanic wins as well.
Absolutely. And I think the story's been told, but maybe not necessarily emphasized enough. you know, Corey's not only the guy spinning the wrenches on Stu's bike, and if you follow Stu on social media, you know, it's late nights, it's long days. You know, Stu, when Stu wants to do bike work and wants to go testing, you know, he doesn't care about things like daylight or rain. You know, so Corey's just in there in the thick of it. But realistically, and Stu knows this, and obviously a lot of the people in the industry know, but Corey McDonald is really influential in Stu even having this ride.
Right.
Not that his results surely have proven it to be one of the best decisions that, you know, Ampro and Randy Hawkins ever made, and Yamaha as well. I mean, this is, you know, the most dominant we've seen a rider on a... There is Stu Baylor, the 514, still out front, still jamming, and still with a pretty solid lead. But Corey McDonald realistically was the one. You know, Stu basically, when he was trying out, he rode that Kawasaki. Yep. You know, he rode so many different bikes in that span of a couple months there. And, you know, the story goes, and I heard a good part of this from Stu's own mouth. He said he had reached out to Corey and said, hey, do you think Randy would give me a shot? You know, you think I could come ride that Yamaha? And initially the answer was absolutely not. You know, we have our team. You know, Stu, you're your own thing. Everybody loves you, but you're not a good fit for us in this program. You know, and I don't think Stu didn't give up on it, and neither did Corey. You know, they just kind of kept hounding. Hounding might not be the right word for it, but they kept asking. And I think, you know, Randy really wanted to see Yamaha up front battling for wins. He knew the talent that Stu had. And so the legend goes, so the story goes, you know, Stu and Randy finally sat down, and Randy said, like, you know, hey, we do things a little bit differently here. You know, we don't want to change who you are. And a lot of this was brought up at GNCC University in the talks. Jordan Ashburn still there in the number two spot. You know, Randy said it best. He said, you know, we want to kind of monitor what Stu does and how he does things, but we don't want to change Stu Baylor. Right. We don't want to take Stu out of Stu. We just want him to be who he is and do what he does within the parameters that Yamaha has set forth as a brand and Ampro has set forth as a team. And I think it's been a great, there's no question, it's been a great match on and off the track.
I agree wholeheartedly. And you got to commend Randy for taking the risk and the chance, because like you said, you know, he's got a certain set of bylaws of his own team that, you know, he likes to follow. And I respect and I admire the fact that he doesn't want to take the Stu out of Stu.
Sure. No, and I think, and Stu may not see it this way, but I 100% agree with what you just said, taking a risk. Ben Kelly there still in the third place spot, a little bit of a gap over Josh Toth, so maybe coming a little bit more comfortable, I guess, as you will, a little bit of a pad time-wise, with about 6 miles left of racing to secure that final podium spot. But it was a risk, there's no question. Stu's always had the talent. He's shown that he can win races, you know, but he's kind of been a wild card. The inconsistency, the injuries, there was a lot of stuff going on with Stu. And, man, taking the risk turned out to be such a smart, smart move.
Well, Stu Baylor leading this one by well over a minute now over Jordan Ashburn. Ben Kelly in third, Josh Toth in fourth, Thad Duval rounding out the top five. Can Stu Baylor make it win number six on his anniversary of riding the Yamaha here in Beckley, West Virginia? Stick around. GNCC Live continues after this.
Rocky Mountain ATV MC, retailer, distributor, manufacturer, product developer, parts tester. This is what we do, but who we are is something much simpler. We're riders, like you. 100% employee owned and operated, a company built by riders, entirely for riders. Rocky Mountain ATV MC, get ready.
Advance human performance beyond biological limitation.
Born of family values and a homegrown work ethic, Kometic Gaskets seals your machine so you can focus on the finish line. Kometic Gaskets are the competitive standard for racers who demand the very best. Kometic Gaskets are constructed from superior materials designed to perform in the most demanding environment. Whether it's championships on the line or a day in the dirt with friends, professionals and enthusiasts depend on Kometic. Kometic Gaskets, sealing championships since 1989.
AMSOIL runs on freedom and has since 1972. We changed the industry by formulating the first API-qualified 100% synthetic motor oil. The rest of the market has been trying to follow our lead ever since. But a head start is a head start. We punish our products firsthand in our world-class laboratories and beyond. Because some things can't be learned from a test tube. Run with us.
Last season was my best season ever by far. I won a lot of races. I won the championship, and it was also my first year using Arma. And one of the things I noticed was just my ability to string good days together. You know, like especially in the summertime in Florida, where you're riding every day and the heat index is 108 degrees and you're doing 230s and going to the gym and bicycle and all that stuff. I think in the past I've been super inconsistent day to day. Yeah, I may have a good race here or, you know, a good day during the week there, but overall I think where I improved the most was my consistency in my recovery.
RV Superstore is family owned and operated and stake their reputation on offering you the finest RVs available in their McBee, South Carolina RV dealership. Brown's RV Superstore carries motorhomes, fifth wheels, travel trailers, and toy haulers, and keep a huge inventory of new and used RVs in stock for you to choose from. They offer top dollar for your RV trade-in and help you get the RV financing you need. As a part of the GNCC family, Brown's RV Superstore, in partnership with Vengeance Toy Haulers, offers sponsorship packages for every level of racer with discounts and continued savings on your new toy hauler. Brown's RV Superstore has dedicated themselves to complete customer satisfaction, specializing in providing a positive start to your RV adventure. They look forward to customers coming back to share their tales from the road. Call Brown's RV Superstore today at 877-805-3658 or visit their website at brownsrvsuperstore.com, where family fun begins. This Racer TV broadcast is brought to you by Specialized. Specialized Turbo E-Bikes. It's you, only faster. And by Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
And welcome back to GNCC Live from Beckley, West Virginia, and the Summit Bechtel Reserve, the Scout Camp, if you will. Some 10,000-plus acreage facility that houses a lot of great things, including Freedom Fest and GNCC this weekend, and GNCC 1 year ago. As we take a look back here on Racer TV, this is the way things started out last year. Caleb Russell, who was in pursuit of his eighth and final championship, got off to an early lead out in this one with Ben Kelly back in the number two spot. Looks like we also had Stu Baylor back there lurking as well on the 514 as he was working his way up through the pack in this one, Johnny.
This was the race that started the run. You know, you said just a moment ago his sixth win of 2021 is what he's working on. Well, this was the first win of 2020, first of four out of five tries, finishing second in the only other race he raced in 2020 on that AmPro Yamaha. So when you add those together, I mean, this was the first one, but this was the first of what would be 10 at the end of the day today if he finishes this one out. 10 wins in 14 tries for Stu Baylor. That's a pretty dominant run there.
And when you look at the times that he came up a little short, and the times that he didn't get a chance to run, you're looking at he didn't even race one race. He came back still under the weather, finishing 14th in the other. And basically any other race, he's been close to the podium, if not on the podium.
He actually has been on the podium every round, with the exception of that mechanical in Florida where he finished 14th and not racing round one. He has won 10 times. He has 2 seconds and 1/3 in the other round. So those are like Caleb Russell dominant kind of statistics. Yes, it's a short span. If you look at, you know, Caleb's run of I don't even know how many races over the course of the 7-8 championships that he won. Stu Baylor from one calendar year, that's about as dominant as anybody can be.
Yeah, the switch really flipping, and it's amazing how the dominance comes at such a force, you know. And maybe, you know, it's been a force that's been building for a long time, a storm, so to speak, because, I mean, that's exactly what he's done, is taken that podium by storm in the last 14 races, just like you said, Johnny. A year later, here we are. I mean, didn't know if he was going to, even after taking that win here last year, didn't know if he was going to still be able to ride the following week on that that same brand Yamaha. So pretty amazing. Just that whole story, and what you were leading back to, what you were talking about with his mechanic, Corey McDonald, and everything. I mean, definitely the kind of backstories that really make, I think, for great championship stories, a movie almost. You know, it could be a movie like.
Yeah, you know, it's been a very exciting but bumpy ride for Stu Baylor throughout his career. Again, that XC2 title, a lot of national enduro titles, some sprint enduro titles, a few GNCC wins here and there, but not the anything even remotely approaching what he's done here in the last 12 months. He's really, you put it perfectly, flipped a switch.
That's what he's done, and he's leaving it on. He ain't let anyone turn it off right now. So as we continue to motor toward the finish line and the conclusion of this race day, we await at mile marker number 8, the leaders, and we still anticipate Stu Baylor to check in with us on the AmPro Yamaha number 514. Should be seeing that number plate sneak in here within, I believe, the next minute or so. When he comes to this area on the racetrack, if he's staying steady with the paces that we've seen so far this race.
Yep, Stu Baylor at this point would have about 2 miles left and no major challenges.
Here he is
on screen.
Yep, so alternate line choice, staying out of that main deep line. He's finding the smooth way around this racetrack, and that's what wins these races, man. I mean, line choices, you got to be able to make the switch on the fly. You don't just follow the trail, you follow the line.
Absolutely, and you know, it's funny you say that line's actually been there all race. Trevor Bollinger made that on lap one, if I'm not mistaken, now lap number 6. That's the first time Stu Baylor's actually taken that line.
That's crazy, isn't it?
So he might be finding the good lines elsewhere, but it took him 6 tries to find that one.
Well, look at that hill now. And I imagine if we looked at that by comparison, a lap-by-lap comparison, starting at yesterday, can you imagine what the time lapse of that would be? That would be crazy.
Oh, yeah. It's these places get chewed up, and you know, we'll have about 365 days for the boys will go out there starting as soon as the race ends with the little mini dozers and push that ground back together and even throw some seed in some areas where it's applicable to try to mend that ground back together so that we have a good surface to race on. I'm sure we'll be back here. I know the Summit Bechtel facility is excited to have us, and we're surely excited to be here. So a great weekend of racing, amazing weather all weekend, and you know, another great GNCC racing weekend just about in the books here. About 2 miles left for Stu Baylor, and Cohart's behind him. Still got to sort out those final podium spots, but we should be watching for the number 3, the Magna 1 Lubricants of Jordan Ashburn with that bright yellow helmet.
There he is.
Right on cue. There he is. And, man, can't really say enough about Jordan and how solid he's been today.
Right.
Again, we talked about he does well in these conditions, but I didn't necessarily kind of have it be a foregone conclusion that he would be as solid as he was today. Oh, well, look at this. Now Ben Kelly putting in a push, and he's gotten up quite a bit closer to Jordan Ashburn. So if I don't know if there's enough track left, but it's less than 15 seconds.
Yeah, it's getting close. Yeah,
he's really put in a push there to try to get even closer to Jordan Ashburn. You know, he's probably got some pit boards, so he knows Jordan's up there, and he's definitely now broken free of his pursuer and his teammate Josh Toth. So he's solidly in that third place spot. But potentially, and that would be a big, big, big 4 points, which would keep him in sole remaining possession of that points leader reverse plate.
109.580. That was the gap between Jordan Ashburn and Ben Kelly. 1 minute and 9 seconds, and we see that that has been chipped away at quite a bit. If Ashburn maybe not realizing that that Ben Kelly's coming at the pace he's coming, he may get a wake-up call coming pretty soon. And even though it's only, still 2 miles away from the finish, and that's not a long ways as Stu Baylor makes his way past the 9-mile marker. As we've seen, a lot of things can happen in 2 miles. 16 seconds is what we're being told is the distance between the second and third place position. So, Johnny, that's almost a minute already made up. So conceivably, I mean, in theory, I expect that Ben Kelly will catch Jordan Ashburn.
16 seconds is still a pretty solid gap. And at some point, if Ben can't catch him by the time we see them here at the 9-mile marker, it's going to be incredibly right. difficult. And here's why. Once they get to this point, there's 3 switchbacks where you can see a pretty good little ways behind right. you. If Jordan doesn't know he's coming, he's going to know very soon after we see them on camera right here at the 9-mile marker. He's going to be able to look over his shoulder and see Ben Kelly coming. And, you know, I got to believe Jordan's got enough sprint left for that final mile. If Ben isn't within, I'm going to say if he's not within 5 seconds when we see him, I don't think he realistically has a shot.
Well, we'll see here in just a few moments as we wait at the 9-mile marker on Jordan Ashburn to check through. And how close can Ben Kelly get on this last lap push as we head toward the finish line? 9 seconds is what that gap is down to now, Johnny, is what we're being told.
I'm sticking to my number, 5. If it's not 5 by the time they get here, I don't think he's going to have enough time to get it done.
Well, we'll see. Here he comes, and it's going to be tough to make up that 4 seconds. He's definitely well within that.
1,007, 1,008. Yeah, it's about 8 or 9 seconds. He's chopped it in half in just a mile, but I think Jordan knows that he's there now. Yeah. You can tell by the way he's riding. He knows, unless Jordan has some kind of an issue, be it a bib starting to come apart or something like that, I think he's going to be able to hold Ben Kelly off to the finish line.
Well, there you could see Ben Kelly has him in his sights at this particular moment in some of these open areas of the woods. So if he sees him and if he happened to look back in one of those tighter sections like you were talking about, you're right. He is going to pick up the pace. And it almost looked like he was riding at a little more sense of urgency there than what we had seen him earlier in this lap.
Yeah, he definitely, you could tell he, I think he knows Ben Kelly is there. How close exactly, I don't know if he knows, but he knows he's coming. He's definitely gotten the word. And Jordan's going to give it everything he's got to try and hold him off the finish line. But this guy right here gave it everything he had all but one lap today. And 5 out of 6 laps in GNCC race and being the fastest guy out there isn't a bad odd to put yourself in position to win a race.
It is not. As Stu Baylor makes his way out of that final wood section, a look over the head and a celebratory rev as he takes his 10th win in 1 year, celebrating here at the place it all began for Stu Baylor and AmPro Yamaha.
Oh, he's upset. He wanted somebody to see that or to be able to film that. And he kept looking back and waiting for him. And he was saying, hey, look, here, we got a broken off rear fender. Stu's getting pretty good at those. I think Corey McDonald said, what people don't realize is that's like 18 bolts to change that rear fender. And he said he hates changing them, but as long as Stu's winning, he doesn't mind go ahead and swapping them out every couple weeks.
So there you have it. Stu Baylor puts another one in the history books there. And that's, like we said, his 10th win since we all started. Almost looks like a backrest on there now. So
Big win. This is a big day for Stu Baylor today, as he is certainly, I'm sure, excited about this. But we still wait patiently for that second place position. Is Jordan going to be able to keep Ben Kelly at bay? And there they come. Ooh. Nose to tail.
Oh, there is a line here through these weeds. I don't know if anybody's seen it. I don't know if anybody's used it. But you can blitz through. Oh, look at this.
Uh-oh.
He squares him up.
Oh! Ben Kelly goes underneath Jordan Ashburn, two turns away to take the second place position, and all of a sudden re-secure the points lead heading into round number 11, Johnny Gallagher. Jordan Ashburn, an amazing race today, still holds on for a top three and solid third place finish. But wow, what a big change of events there, Johnny. I guess 5 seconds, it was, didn't have to be the 5 seconds, huh?
Ben Kelly sent it just full send.
He did.
All the way through those final turns. And they're discussing whether or not, I don't know if they're happy about that contact. It almost looked like Jordan had started to lose the front end, but there could have been contact made there. But, you know, hey, that's a last corner, second to last corner attempt for the pass. And look at this. This is, he just goes wide. Jordan doing what he thinks he needed to do, protecting this inside line as they exit the woods. Ben Kelly outside squares him up and just drives right for the inside. And, yeah, you can see they connected handlebars.
Yeah.
But Jordan fumbled just enough to give Ben that opening on the inside. And, yeah, man, that's racing as far as I see it. That's a last corner, last-ditch effort. And they just kind of clipped bars as they went by. Jordan was fumbling just a little bit in that corner, and Ben drove it in.
Hey, that's the name of the game. That's racing. And Ben Kelly going for and trying to maintain the championship points lead, and with that pass does just exactly that.
Yeah, and hats off to Jordan Ashburn. I mean, what a ride for him today to put himself on the podium again, and really honestly was Stu Baylor's biggest challenger all day long, and for quite a bit, 2 hours into this race, had himself in position where he was with inside of Stu Baylor with a very realistic shot to win this race. So, Jordan, we are definitely not overlooking you anymore, buddy. Consistent podium threat. You and that Magna One Lubricants Husqvarna rode an amazing race today and still on the podium. Get a chance to thank your sponsors. But the man of the hour, the man of the day, Stu Baylor. And, this is the first race that we've had a young Baylor with us in Stu with the refreshments, baby in hand, and just all little too much for baby Baylor right now. He's going to take himself a nap.
Look at that. Yep, that's another big change that's taken place in the last year in Stu Baylor's life as well. He's become a father, and he's trying to wake up, celebrate with Dad. Love some babies there. I got a grandson about that old right there.
Well, hey, we're down here with Stu Baylor, guys. Stu's adjusting, trying to get the baby in the shade, man. Stu, I don't know what else to say, man. You're undefeated as a dad.
Yeah, you're right.
Talk about this race today, man. I mean, that was almost flawless for you out there today.
Yeah, you know, I pushed really hard right there off the start to get to the front, and we were able to capitalize. I just had a couple really good lines, just set up lines, and a lot of the track changed a good bit, and it looked like it was a good line. You get on it and you get turned around, and main trail for the most part ended up getting really fast. And you know, for me, that was where I was finding my speed and making my passes, was a lot of times on the main trail or just setting up some outside lines and just trying to find that flow, and got in contention for that lead. And I was like, all right, you know, we'll put down the hammer. And Jordan was right there. And you know, mid race, I was watching the pit boards, trying to do my best, manage it. And prior to the race, you know, I talked about the hopefully Bolton's not soft. Well, he wasn't. Saw him out there, and they left that section in all day, and I had two really rough times through there, just threw away 45 seconds in one section. But that was an amazing section. I love stuff like that. Luckily, all the pit crew was out there. I mean, KTM, GasGas, Yamaha, everybody was throwing out lines, helping us through there and keeping it from getting clogged up. You know, Caleb Russell was down there, and, you know, the whole crew just making sure that we kept that section in. And, you know, that was old school GNCC.
Old school GNCC, old school win. That is your winner here today. He's undefeated as a dad. Make some noise for Stu Baylor.
Wow. And little Baylor coming to life there as the interview is underway. Those big eyes certainly looking up at Dad. And, you know, I'm sure one day he'll look back at this video and think, how awesome was that, you know, to be a part of the winning celebration there at
There's another part of the Baylor winning celebration. Well, he's finishing whatever was in that koozie. We don't know what it was, but he sure looked thirsty for it.
Well, there is a rider that rode his tail off today, and the comeback ride that he had there on the last couple of laps, very impressive to take over the second place position for Ben Kelly like that was definitely a ride. And that was what you got to do to salvage championships. And, you know, they say that your championships are won on worst days. This wasn't a worst day, but championships are also won with last-ditch efforts, gaining all you can in the final moments on the days that you can't win. And right there, this could make it even more exciting as far as this championship is concerned, with Ben Kelly taking the second place here today.
Down here with Ben Kelly, getting his mind right, got the freshie on. Ben, I don't know what else to say, man. Wow, what a finish.
Yeah, damn. Had a good jump off the line, but just kind of slid out, and those guys were able to get me, and it was weird. I was, like, first. Next thing I know, I was in like, sixth, three corners later. And, yeah, those guys, everyone was rolling on the first lap. You know, track was super slick, and everyone has the lines dialed, so it's kind of like just a freight train through the woods. And, yeah, we got to a nasty rock garden. I was right behind Josh, and it was weird. We just, like, we took different lines, and both of us just, like, slingshotted by three guys. So that was super nice, and... yeah, he was on rail, so I was following him for a long time and was able to get by him and kind of pull away. And then there I was in third, but way behind these guys, Jordan and Stu. They kind of checked out, and I had some hard crashes there in the middle of the race when I was trying to catch him. And then, you know, the time just kept going up, like, by big chunks. And, yeah, I was, you know, I felt like I was riding good, but just kept making mistakes and crashing, just struggling to focus out there. And on the fifth lap, Josh caught me, and I was like, man, I felt like I was doing everything I could, but he was just faster, and he was right on my wheel, so I just focused and was able to stay ahead of him. You know, it was right on my wheel that whole second to last lap, and then that last lap I was able to stay clean and focus, and took a huge chunk out of the lead, and was catching Jordan. And yeah, I came into that bike only. It was like 2 miles from the finish, and they said I was only 20 seconds down, and I was charging, had a little tip over, and was cramping up, but I just kept pushing through, and saw another pit board minus 10, and next thing I know, like a quarter mile from the finish, I could see him, and two different line, almost passed them there in the woods, but we kind of, the lines came together, and neither of us wanted to give it up. We kind of bounced off each other, but I stayed in it. You know, my front wheel smacked the side of his bike, so my front brake rotor bent, and so I had no front brakes, and I was like, man, how am I gonna run it in on him with no front brakes? But I don't know, I somehow just rode those last few corners good and squared him up coming out of the woods into the field, and just in that slippery dust, I squared him up, got that inside line, and was able to take second. So that's definitely a big win for me to get second for those points. You know, I needed it. Championship's close, keeping it interesting, but yeah, I'm feeling good. This is first race back from summer, so getting the jitters out, and three more races. I'm ready to get after it.
Ready to get after it. Boy, the stage has been set for these last three rounds. There's your second place finisher, Ben Kelly.
Well, Auntie Colin, and giving him a big congratulatory hug there. As you know, he liked to see that last lap push that he saw coming out of Ben Kelly there, and able to rise to the occasion and salvage good things out of this race day today. And another rider that just had an amazing ride today, and just maybe got taken by surprise right there at the end. Jordan Ashburn taking that third place position. He too has a little newbie, it looks like, huh? Twins. Oh, mercy.
Yeah, twins for Jordan. I think Jordan might have had the twins before.
Okay.
Snowshoe, but the rider.
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah. Right before, but there they are.
Jordan, somebody's going to have to hold the microphone for Jordan, because he's got twins. Stu can hold a beer, a microphone, and a baby. Jordan's going to need a little assistance.
Hey, Jordan started with one. I said, you better hold them both, because 5 years from now, whoever you're not holding is going to be a little upset. So Jordan's pulling double duty up here. Mary's close by. They're going to take them back. Jordan's like, I'm a little nervous here. I got my hands full. Jordan, you had your hands full today. It was an incredible ride, incredible finish. I know you wanted that second place. Ben Kelly able to edge you out a little bit there. Tell us the story of the day, man.
Oh yeah, so I got the whole shot today, and I was pretty happy. I had to get out front early, and
You know, Stu was going fast, man. He was cooking, and I just tried to latch on to him, and just seemed like I just stayed back and kind of yo-yoed for a while, and never really got close enough to follow him, but just kind of rode by myself. And going to that last lap, I think I had like a minute on Ben, and in that last rock section, I fell coming up the hill, and I just gassed me completely. And I think he was like 20 seconds or so behind me at that point. And yeah, just, man, I was struggling after that and took the wind out of me. And we got together a couple times before the finish, and then he got the last one, and he got it, so congrats to him. But, I'm happy with my day. We rode good, and the bike's excellent. The whole team's been great. So, it's awesome.
He's happy. There's your third-place finisher here today, Jordan Ashburn.
Well, that's good that Jordan still happy, and he's got a lot to be happy for, man. I mean, it's been a great season. This Magna One Motorsports team, really meshing well together, I think, and I think he's a great addition and a great part of the team also.
Yeah, and as you pointed out, another solid ride for Jordan today. Not only a third-place finish and so close to second there on the day, challenging Stu throughout much of the day, but also really solidifying himself in that points battle over the third and final podium position in the points for the season. A little bit of a gap back from, Ben Kelly, your leader, and Stu Baylor in second. But, you know, the number three on that machine results, you know, from his last year's hard work, and it's looking like he wants to put himself in that position again.
Well, it looks like we've got our top 10 that have checked in. Baylor, Kelly, Jordan Ashburn, Josh Toth getting that fourth place position. Thad Duvall rounding out the top five. A consistent day for him. Sixth place overall for XC2 250 Pro Class winner Jonathan Girard. Craig DeLong finishing up in the number seven spot, about 24 seconds back, with Mike Witkowski in eighth place overall and third in the XC2 class, another minute and 9 seconds back. Then it was Roy Barbosa, the Chilean, in the number four spot of class, ninth place overall. Trevor Bollinger, who finished sixth in the XC1 Pro class, will take 10th place overall today.
Yeah, Rodney, and you know, Thad Duvall, fifth overall. You know, it's not a podium, but that's Thad's best ride here recently. And that's got to be a good building block for him as we try to close out this 2021 season.
Yes, it does. And building blocks are what makes a great program. And he's had to rebuild. But the good thing about it is he has a great foundation. There's no doubt about that. That's going to pretty much wrap things up as far as today's racing is concerned, Johnny. We'll be back in a couple of weeks as we head to the Burr Oak GNCC at the home of Nate and Out John Penton GNCC at Millfield, Ohio. Looking forward to that one. And on behalf of us all here at Racer TV, of course, I'm Rodney Tomlin, Johnny Gallagher, and Mikey Waynes. Have a great day, everybody.